There are lots of big games in college football, but in Big Ten country, Michigan, Ohio State will do just fine. You like memories? Let's go back to the 50s. The Snow Bowl at Columbus. Michigan's Chuck Ortman punted 24 times. Ohio State's Vic Janowitz 21 times. Blocked punts equaled a 9-3 Michigan win. And a lot of cold feet. 1960s, highlights of the game of 69 in Ann Arbor. The Buckeyes unbeaten, ranked number one of the nation, led by Woody Hayes. The first year at Michigan for Bo Schembechler. And you know what? It was a slam banger. Michigan quarterback Don Moorhead led a steady offense. And the Michigan defense took advantage of many opportunities, including six pass interceptions. And it wound up a 24-12 Michigan win, one of the big upsets of the 60s. Moving into the 70s, they called it the 10-year war. 73, for example, the Buckeyes tore down the M banner when they entered Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, and that made everybody mad. And after that act, after much heroics, banging, hurting, trying and crying, it wound up a 10-10 tie. The Big Ten athletic directors voted to send Ohio State back to the Rose Bowl a second successive time, and they are still mad about it in Michigan. 1974 in Columbus, Tom Clabin kicked four field goals, Ohio State won 12-10, and Coach Woody Hayes understood perfectly the impact of a Michigan game.
You put out so much in this Michigan game that even your Rose Bowl is anticlimactic. Turns out that way you're flat after you've played that Michigan game, because that is your season.
In the 1980s, the Wolverines have stepped forward so far, 9 bowl games, 4 Rose Bowls, and today the Wolverines will try to lock down a 5th Rose Bowl trip. But rewards or no, it's the rivalry, the big game, the kind of game that causes cousins to forget birthdays and coaches to sleep on the office couch all week, just getting ready.
But of all the rivalries that I've seen or been associated with, this is the greatest. And regardless of who's coaching the teams, Michigan and Ohio State will always be a great rivalry.
The 86th meeting between the Ohio State Buckeyes and the Michigan Wolverines. This one is in Ann Arbor. But home field has never meant all that much in this series. Looking at the Big Ten Conference standings, you find that if Michigan wins today, the Wolverines are off to the Rose Bowl to repeat as Big Ten champions, facing Southern California, the Pac-10 champions. I might add that no one has repeated in the Big Ten since the middle 60s when Michigan State repeated as champion. Now, if Ohio State beats Michigan today and Illinois beats Northwestern, then the Illini will go west to the Rose Bowl. If Ohio State beats Michigan and Northwestern beats Illinois, then it can be the Buckeyes heading west. But everybody around this part of the country figures Michigan has the best chance to get the ticket to travel to the west. This is the time of year when you start bumping into folks that don't like you from 1939. These are the days when you go to snake pits. Old foes, tradition, legacy, it all shows up. But it's a wonderful, warm time of year because generations come back together one more time. Now let us join Roger Twibel at our studios in New York. Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor will have more than 100,000 people for a 91st consecutive game today. The weather promise is pretty good for the last Saturday in November. That's almost balmy this time of the year. And it's obviously the Ohio State-Michigan showdown. And Bob Greasy, as we start consideration of this ball game, is a bit of a black cloud in that both starting tailbacks are bunged up. Tony Bowles is out. He's had a touch of knee surgery already for the Michigan Wolverines, may not even be back for the Rose Bowl. And Carlos Snow has hobbled himself and will not start.
And Michigan can deal with that problem a little bit better than Ohio State since they have more depth. Leroy Hard will start, the most valuable player in the Rose Bowl last year. But for Ohio State, their strength is in their offense and that big offensive line. In fact, they lead the Big Ten in 5 offensive categories. Defensively, that's where they have their problem, their Achilles heel. They have four starters out for the year because of injuries. What their offense likes to do is get on the field, control the football, and protect their defense.
And it's incredible. We're going to see two of the biggest offensive lines that ever played the game today, and particularly at the college level. Last night, talking with Ohio State coach John Cooper, I asked Coop how he felt Michigan could beat him.
They'll beat us if we don't protect our quarterback. We have got to protect Greg Fry and give him time to throw the ball and give him time to pick out his second and third receivers. Michigan, the strength of Michigan's football teams are secondary. They do a great job disguising our coverage. You got great athletes in the secondary, and you don't see many people getting big plays on them. We've got to make some big plays if we have a chance.
Now, the Michigan Wolverines have won 9 in a row since letting Raghib Ismail get loose in the Notre Dame game back in September. And I think right now probably as complete a Michigan team as I've seen in recent years.
Well, they are, and there's no surprise there. Defensively, that's their strength. They're number one total defense and number one against the rush. No surprise there. Offensively, a surprise. They almost throw for as much yardage as they rush for. Michael Taylor, the fifth-year senior quarterback, has never lost a Big Ten game that he has started.
Well, the way the crowd is reacting, one would get the feeling the Buckeyes are about ready to come into the stadium, but I guess they're just waiting in the tunnel for a moment. The Michigan defensive bunch strikes me in the games we have seen this year that it's they just tighten the screws as the day goes on.
Well, they do, and it's not a fancy multiplicity of types of defenses. They are very simple, very basic, very easy to study, but they're very sound and very good at what they do. They slant a little bit up front, they play some zones in the secondary, and occasionally they'll blitz a little bit, but it's very, very sound and very solid, and they've led the Big Ten for the last few years.
We asked Coach Bo Schembechler last night how he felt that Ohio State could beat him.
For Ohio State to beat us, our offense is going to have to turn the ball over, and we're going to have to play a poor game offensively. We don't intend to do that. We should move the football and we should score some points, but you never know.
And now a summary comment, Bob.
Well, it's an old cliche, but it's true in this game, big ball games. Two things win big ball games. Number one is defense, and secondly is the team that makes the fewest mistakes. Michigan leads the Big Ten in both of those categories. For Ohio State to win, they're going to have to run the football, sure, but they're going to have to get a good ball game out of their quarterback, Greg Fry. He's going to have to throw the ball to loosen up the defense so they can run. Michigan is going to be Michigan. They just come out and play air-free ball, make no mistakes, either turnovers, interceptions, or in the kicking game, and not help Ohio State win this ball game.
Ohio State, you see the conference and overall record there. John Cooper's second season over at Columbus. He came there from Arizona State. While at Arizona State, he did take the Sun Devils to a Rose Bowl win, and it was against Michigan. Now let's check in with Mike Adamley.
Keith, you know, most of the Ohio State players reluctantly admit that Michigan probably has a little more talent. But John Cooper in the locker room before the game, he's not given too much to fire and brimstone. He was very organized, and he preached to his offense. He said, we're not the number one offense in the Big Ten for nothing. We are good, and we can be good today against Michigan. Just play with poise and play with confidence. He also told me that Carlos Snow, the running back, even though he told us last night that he should play, will not play today. He could not warm up. That right knee bothers him way too much. And so Carlos Snow is out of this football game. Keith?
All right, Mike, thanks very much. Last night I asked the two coaches where the game would swing. Here's their answer.
Swing in a kicking game. The kicking game. The big difference in these ball games is the kicking game. We got to be sound in the kicking game. We got to eliminate big plays, but I think most importantly, we got to be, if we're sound in the kicking game and don't give them big plays, we got a chance.
I think the defenses will tell a story, or any big plays in the kicking game, or any mistakes in a close ball game like this. Our defense has to play a lot better than it ever played down there a year ago, and their defense is going to have to stop us. So I don't want a situation where Ohio State controls the ball for long periods of time. And that's been their tendency the last half a dozen games, and we don't want that to happen.
Now the Wolverines have gathered at the tunnel, and they're waiting for the captain to lead them into the stadium. As we said, more than 100,000 here for this game. again. 91 times in a row they have had home crowds of more than 100,000, which is the reason they dominate attendance in college football every year. And now everybody seems to be in place. I guess still waiting for the captain. And we want, this is one of the great moments, I think, in college football, when you've got this kind of a crowd and in a setting like this, to watch them come bolting out. Because at this particular moment, every team, everywhere, is a winner. There's nothing quite as exhilarating as running onto the field of combat.
Well, it's kind of like what college football is all about. The home team has a big advantage, and this is part of it right here, when the crowd waits for the home team to come running through the banners.
The Wolverines, 9-1 on the year, 7-0 in the Big Ten. Bo Schembechler's 21st season here at Michigan. He has won a mere 13 conference championships in those 21 years, and that ties him with his mentor, Woody Hayes. But Bo has done it in seven fewer seasons than did Woody.
Wait for the guys.
So the toss of the coin now. John Nealon is the referee. These are departing seniors, graduating seniors for both teams.
Okay, guys, will you want to shake hands if you would? The official captain's Grant Walker. Shake hands if you would.
Also, special medical.
Okay, guys. Thank you. I'm John Neal, and this is Frank Strosha. Well, hi, you're going to call it. Who's the designated caller? Number 10 will call it in the air. If I drop it, we'll flip it again.
Thank you.
Call it.
Number 10 is Derek
Eisenman. He calls a tail. It is a head. Michigan, you have won the toss. Michigan has won and will defer. Give me room, guys. Give me room.
So Michigan wants the ball to start the second half of play, meaning Ohio State will have the first offensive possession. And now we're ready for the ceremonial moment. To emphasize how fortunate we are with the weather we have today for this 86th game between the Buckeyes and the Wolverines. It's in the 43-4 degrees range, very light breeze. And over the last 10 years, you can see these two teams are dead even. So it is one of the big college football games in the nation, and the biggest in this neck of the woods. Dante Lee and Bobby Olive are the deep people to receive it. J.D. Carlson kicks it off, and J.D. hammered it to the goal line. Lee on his way. Door closes at the 16-yard line. So that's where Ohio State will go to work. First down at their own 16. When we came to the stadium this morning, they had just taken the tarp off, and there was moisture on the field, obviously under the tarp yesterday, and it was frozen. And there was a goodly bit of ice that they scraped off of it, but it is now melted and gone, and the footing will be good. So Greg Fry ready to pull the trigger on the first play of the ball game. The big number 91, Mike Teeter, settles down over the Ohio State center, Dan Beatty. The Buckeyes in the silver and gray and purple, and here comes the outside, comes Scotty Graham. That is a play that Graham has run a lot this year. He has the quickness to bounce outside from the fullback position. He stands 5'10", weighs 225, is only a sophomore. Lee is a freshman from Dayton, Ohio. Jeff Graham, Greg Beatty are the wideouts for the Buckeyes, and up front, they are big. And start with Stasniak and go that way. 290, 305, 275, 295, 310 for Moxley, and Jim Palmer at 6'5 and 250, the tight end. Second down and one for the Buckeyes. Fry gives to Graham. Scotty Graham reaches inside and will have the first down as Eric Anderson brings him down. The down three for Michigan are Mike Evans, Mike Teeter, and Chris Hutchinson. Hutchinson being a redshirt freshman and Evans a sophomore. The backers are very good. Alex Marshall and Bobby Abrams outside. Eric Anderson, J.J. Grant inside. And the secondary, one of the best in the country. The corners are David Key and Todd Flay. Tripp Welburn and Veda Murray are the safeties. Murray is the center fielder. First down Buckeyes at their own 27. Dante Lee, that quick little 175-pounder out of Dayton, pops it out just short of the 35-yard line. He's playing with a sore foot, but he looked pretty quick there, didn't he?
As you mentioned, Keith, a true freshman, he comes into this ball game. He was number three on the depth chart when the season started, behind Carlos Snow and James Bryant. Both of those out of the ball game today because of injuries. May have a problem if something happens to him. Here's a look at the visor that Fry is wearing. He's not trying to protect himself. He's just wearing it so the defensive alignment, the linebackers, can't see where he's looking.
Lee again with the ball, jitterbugging around. Quick feet. Boy, he doesn't hardly touch the ground once he gets the ball. Mike Teeter, though, introduces him to Mother Earth as he crosses the 40 to the 41. And another Ohio State first down.
That's what we talked about in the opening. Ohio State dominating the Big Ten offensive rankings. They average 245 yards on the ground and 173 through the air.
I go to the fullback, Scotty Graham, there. He picks up a short yardage as he bumps into Eric Anderson. And when Anderson gets his shoulder square on you, you're not going to run over him. That was sort of a left-handed move, but Ohio State is basically a right-handed football team. The first four runs were all to the right side for 9, 1, 8, and 6 yards. First possession of the ball game, and Ohio State is moving. It is second down and seven. Ball at the Buckeye 44. Right-handed run again. This time coming up out of his outside backer position, Bobby Abrams. Took away the momentum and dropped him right at the line of scrimmage. John Cooper says this about how to beat Michigan.
We beat Michigan controlling the line of scrimmage. We beat Michigan by keeping the ball away from their football team. We beat them by being sound in the kicking game. We beat them, I think, by winning the kicking game, I should say. I think we've got to win that battle to have a chance.
Native son of Tennessee. Obviously, if you coach football and come from Tennessee, you are very familiar with the teachings of a man named Neelan. Third down, seven. Fry still hasn't thrown it, gives it back to Dante Lee, and Lee can't find any room as Chris Hutchinson wraps him up. And the big freshman from Houston takes him down, and the Buckeyes will have to punt.
Ohio State obviously is going to throw the ball when they want to throw the ball. Third and seven, third and eight. Michigan very tough defensively. Ohio State keeps it on the ground.
Jeff Bowman in to punt. If you get a rush on him, you might get him because he's not the quickest guy around in getting it away. And sometimes he can just knock it out of town. Taken back there by Tripp Welburn, number three. And Welburn, the big junior from Greensboro, 220-pounder, will give the Wolverines pretty good field position. They'll own it first down at their own 27.
My greatest experience, I think, was probably my senior year. Going down to Columbus and being from Ohio, playing the game in the horseshoe was a real thrill. Plus, we shut them out 22-0 that year. That was probably my fondest experience.
The man who in 21 years has become a bit of a legend on the right, John Cooper, seeking to find his place as the boss man of Ohio State. And the first play of the ball game for the Michigan Wolverines is Leroy Horde. And that's bad news right there for Ohio State, because Horde ripped off just about 10 yards on his opening carry. Michael Taylor is an option quarterback in there for Michigan, 190-pounder senior. Leroy Horde, a big 220-pound junior. Tony Bowles is out, remember. Jared Bunch is back at 240 pounds with Callaway and McMurtry, two of the best wideouts in the country. Walker, the tight end, across the front now, starting with Doering, Michigan. 290, 290, 280, 270, 340 with Scripita.
That averages out to 292 pounds. On the other side for Ohio State, their offensive line averaging 295, two of the biggest in the Big Ten.
Biggest anywhere.
All right, 37-yard line and a first down as Horde ran for 10 on his first carry. Got it again. Guarantee you Michigan will do that all day long until Ohio State makes them change their mind. That's a pickup of about 8 yards. The defensive front for Ohio State is where the weakness might be for the Buckeyes. Zizekovic, Thomas, and Fremel are the three down people. They're 250, 260, 250, not that big. The backers are freshman Lease, sophomore Herman, senior Eisenman playing on guts today, and Spellman, freshman, outside. The secondary is Clark and Brown, the corners, Dumas and Pellini, the safety. Second down, two. Taylor, put it up. Deep pattern sideline, great catch, McMurtry. He just went up and out jumped David Brown. Now, put this in your mind, Greg McMurtry has size and speed over everybody in the secondary of Ohio State.
And it's a poor throw by Taylor, his first one of the day. Watch him as he sets up after the play fake. This ball is going to go much higher than he wanted it to. And it's cold, and he is throwing into the wind, but McMurtry goes up and makes a completion out of it anyway. A bad throw.
Lucky that defender didn't zero him in the rib cage, didn't he? On first down from the Buckeye 41, a penalty flag goes down from the pocket of the referee. It's against Michigan. John Nealon, the referee. Judah Herman is hurt. He is an inside linebacker for Ohio State, and they just simply don't have many. They had a total of four, didn't they?
Well, they can't afford to lose many more. They've already lost three linebackers out for the year. And if you take Eisenman out of there, who is injured, as we get the call here.
Man, still first down.
Six of the next eight linebackers are freshmen for Ohio State.
The Giants and 49ers are playing on ABC's NFL Monday Night Football this next week. Give you an idea of their size compared to Ohio State and Michigan.
Offensive lines.
I mean, you talk about hogs. Now, that's a hogs, right? All right, Steve Tovar is in at the strong linebacker position as Herman had to leave after being shaken up. And on first down and 15, here goes the screen. And it is Jared Bunch, the big fullback. Screens and draws against a green, eager defense.
Just a little shovel pass that time. It's a safe little way to get. It's like a draw, a little shovel pass. Taylor goes back, makes it look like pass, and then shovels it. Bumps into his old man Elliott and makes a nice run out of it. There's two inside linebackers in there now. Eisenman, who is injured, and Tovar, who is a true freshman.
Second down and two. This is Horde. And Leroy Horde, the junior from New Orleans, picking his way off the right side, getting behind Skrepanak. And when Skrepanak gets a block on a fella, normally he's got a pin.
Well, Eisenman, fifth-year senior, missed a few games early in the season with some broken ribs, missed some practice, then broke his thumb 2 weeks ago. Nobody thought he'd play. John Cooper didn't thought he'd play. He's out there today on guts. He is the leader of that defense, and he wanted to be a part of this this ball game.
Horton picked up the first down to the 26 of Ohio State. Michigan now mounting a threat. Michael Taylor, better rotation on the ball this time, except he didn't put it where he wanted it again. He just absolutely threw that one in the cheap seats. Chris Callaway, number two, was the intended receiver, and you can see Taylor shaking his head, knowing full well he did not get on that ball what he wanted on it. Derek Eisenman, to continue his story, is in the Olympic trials, went up against Mike Tyson as an amateur boxer. And he stayed on his feet three rounds. He lost the fight, but he didn't go down. And he was pretty close.
It was that broken thumb we were talking about. Off last year to compete in the Olympic trials.
Second down. Taylor's got his screen going. Horde with the ball. There's the block outside by big number 78, Dean Dingman. And the ball comes out, and Ohio State, they have it, they do. So Horde hanging away, trying to reach for the marker and pick up the first down inside the 16 as the ball come out and Pat Thomas recovers for the Buckeyes. So, Michigan in this instance has helped Ohio State. Another look at it and you'll see the ball. Now, you don't really see it, but you saw David Brown, 27, go underneath him, and it appears David's the man that knocked it out.
Right side of your screen, he hits the ball. Good play and a good call by the officials. This was what we talked about in the opening, how Michigan, to win this ball game, cannot turn the ball over. They came into the ball game leading the Big Ten in the fewest turnovers.
Well, they played two straight games without a fumble.
That's right. That's right.
Shades of last week. Southern California with six turnovers. Helped UCLA to a 10-10 tie. All right, the Buckeyes will start at their 16, and ironically, that's where their first possession started, at the 16. This is Lee, and he stops at the 16. Marshall and Teeter on the tackle for Michigan. Time remaining, first quarter, 7.5 minutes.
There's Marshall, 59, outside linebacker. Blocked by Graham. Just stood him up, held his ground, outside position. That's just good, solid defense.
Fullback. A couple of yards, that'll do it. Bobby Abrams, the principal tackler. Jeff Graham, who is the flanker for Ohio State, number 84, is playing with a bad groin pull. Penn State, I guess, is going to get a postseason trip. I'm sure they will if they beat Penn today. But I think they're on their way anyhow.
And Ohio State has yet to throw a pass.
Nope.
Want to establish the run, but it's going to be tough if they don't. Tough to run if they don't loosen them up with a pass.
Third down and 8. Welburn's up on the line of scrimmage, not blitzing. Here is Fry dropping back, and then Fry gets the pressure, and eventually it's Alex Marshall who gets a hold of him and jerks him just as he throws the ball, and he misses connection.
Keith, from a quarterback standpoint, it's tough to throw your first pass in a big ball game on the road when you're third and 9. Michigan defensively played it very well, and the confidence of Greg Fry has really not been established yet, because there's been 9 running plays and 1 pass incompletion.
And he's basically a rollout kind of guy, spread out kind of guy anyway, isn't he?
And he's got to play well to win.
Bowman's kick is away. Welborn circles under it, makes the catch, and steps out of bounds at the Ohio State 48-yard line. And there Michigan is going to go to work after a 34-yard punt. Judah Herman, among, for the moment at least, the injured, as you saw there, missing those people. Judah has a stinger, apparently, and is going to be all right, I would presume, but he is not on the field at the moment.
One of the problems for a coach is when you have a rash of injuries at one position, and they certainly have had them on defense, but more importantly, in the linebacker position.
And you had to add up those people that you saw there, the starters that lost the injury. My gosh, that's a hole. And that's a huge hole. Michael Taylor keeping the ball, getting a block from Horde. And Taylor goes from the 47 of Ohio State down near the 31. Derek Eisenman finally brought him down. He showed the ball as he came off on the option run, obviously with the intent to indicate to the secondary folks, hold your ground, I may still throw. And then bingo, turned it off.
Well, he's a threat to run at any time. In fact, Bill Young, defensive coordinator at Ohio State, says the biggest thing he's concerned about with Taylor is the quarterback draw and running when the receivers are covered when he takes downfield.
Here's your option pitch to Horde. Horde running away from Spellman. And Lonzo has great speed for an outside backer, but he could not run down Leroy Horde. His number 99 for Ohio State is going to be a great player one of these days, but he's just green as grass right now. He's a 6'6", 255-pound freshman from Mount Holly, New Jersey, and you can entertain yourself all day just watching him play football.
Well, he's a true freshman, and that school is the same one that produced Franco Harris.
He also wears about a 37 and a half sleeve.
38.
Second down and 2 for Michigan. Taylor to the corner for Callaway. No. David Brown defending Callaway was out there early on. Taylor a little bit late getting the ball on its way and kind of threw a floater again.
Well, it's a great call. He got Callaway to the wide side of the field. Man-to-man coverage. The corner was to the inside. This is a pass that should have been completed. You hit it on the head, Keith. You threw the ball too late. The ball should have been there earlier. Callaway should have caught it anyway.
Yeah, it would. Right.
Second and short. Good call by, I guess, Bowles calling most of the plays. Gary Moore, the offensive coordinator, has a vote, but they all go through Bowles.
Third down and 2. The corner, he's got the first down. Ball's inside the 10 to the 13. So Horde now running up some impressive numbers here in this first quarter. He has gains of 10, 8, 7, 8, and 10.
Well, he's starting at halfback or tailback in the place of Tony Bowles. But that is not a come down. Last year, he and Tony Bowles together produced over 2,000 yards out of that one tailback position. And as we mentioned, he was the MVP of the Rose Bowl last January.
Callaway in motion. Horde got the ball. Cuts it back into the middle. That puts him behind Dingman and Everett. And he's inside the 10. This possession starting at the 13. Last time they were down here, Horde fumbled it.
Bo loves being in big ball games. You know, I think he's more excited about, because this means a trip to the Rose Bowl, even if he already had it in his pocket. He loves the big game.
Wishbone, Horde with the ball. They're going to put him close to the 3 and close to the first down. your measure. When Dingman, he started the year with an infection, and when he finally got healthy and got back, from that point on, this offensive front for Michigan had just gotten better and better and better. And where they really sold me, Bob, was in an 80-yard march on the ground in the fourth quarter at Illinois. That was an impressive drive. It is first and goal, Michigan, at the Ohio State 3.
Michigan has had some injuries throughout the year, but they have not come all at the same time. As you mentioned, Dingman was out. They lost Bunch for a while. Taylor was out. Everybody that has played, come in and played for him, has done very well. Now they're all healthy except for Gold.
McGee is in. They've got a double tight end alignment here on the power play coming up on first down and goal. Give it to Allen Jefferson. And Jefferson trying to run it into the middle. Just there was nothing there but a wall of people. And then he tried to bounce it outside, and he didn't gain anything. I mean, there's a bunch of folks stacked up there in the middle. 4 minutes and 10 seconds to go in the first quarter. No score in the ballgame. Michigan had a threat going and turned it over. Now John Vaughn, redshirt freshman from Florissant, Missouri, number 25, is in the backfield. He is the fastest of the backs. Fullback Bunch. And Bunch is down to the one. It'll be third down and goal.
Schembechler has a nice balance of scoring touchdowns, 18 on the ground, 18 through the air. That is a statistic that you like to have, a lot of balance. This year, Schembechler has more passing yardage than he's had in the past several years, and he likes it. Balance that run with the pass.
Jefferson is back in. He and Vaughn apparently are the messengers in this series. Horn to the ball, touchdown. Starting at tailback and realizing that Bowles is hurt and he's got to be the main man is a stimulating adventure for Leroy Orange.
And he's not playing at 100% healthy either. He had some ribs from last week.
J.D. Carlson kicks the extra point. 3:13, first quarter, 7-0 Michigan.
Go back to the last touchdown. Three backs in the backfield. Watch 32 Bunch and 28 Jefferson as they get their blocks. Right there, look at this. Great blocking for the back. He's just going to cut right up inside. And that's why you play at Michigan for Bo Schembechler. Not many Heisman Trophy winners come out of here, but you're complete backs. You can block, you can catch, and you can run the football.
A lot of them go on to the next level of the game.
Oh, no question about it.
Or they go on to meaningful professions. Because most of the time you'll find them walking out with their degree. Dante Lee and Bobby Olive are deep. Lee is 20 and Olive is 8. Olive is a wideout, a junior from Atlanta, Georgia. Lee, as we told you, a freshman from Dayton, Ohio. And Carlson's kick into the wind hangs up at the 6-yard line. It is Lee. Well, he's exciting, but he didn't. All that tap dancing didn't do much good.
He's exciting, night. But he's young. He had no friends over there.
Nope. Nobody to hold his hand. ABC's NFL Monday Night Football, as we told you, matches San Francisco and the Giants. The two teams with the best records in the NFL head to head. Could be a preview, I suppose, of the NFC Championship game. But
well, I think you said it all when you said two teams with the best records in the NFL. Two teams that are playing the best football.
That's at 9 Monday night Eastern time. Giants and the 49ers. I think the Green Bay Packers might have awakened the 49ers. On first down from the 17, Scotty Graham, the fullback. J.J. Grant, 95, grabs a hold of him first. But Graham is across the 20.
Defensive coordinator Lloyd Carr from Michigan. Last week when they got off the bus back at school to play in Minnesota, he took the defense into the film room, put the second half of last year's Ohio State game on just to show the defense so they can have something to think about. 353 yards against Michigan in the second half, 260 on the ground. He wanted to start early, getting his troops thinking about Ohio State.
Little play action, Fry pumps and throws and has a man wide open. That is Brian Stabline. And Stabline, a redshirt freshman from Erie, Pennsylvania, gives the Bucks the first down near the 40.
This is what Ohio State has to do more of, and that is throw in running situations. Look at Michigan's defensive rankings. First in total defense against the run, quarterback sacks, interceptions. Ohio State has a high tendency to run the ball in running situations. They have to break that and break some of their keys and throw the ball on running situations.
From the 40, first down for the Buckeyes. And Fry again will put it up. Incomplete forward pass. Peter and Hutchinson were like two falling trees. Fry saw him coming. He seemed for a second transfixed, but then finally unloaded.
This should have been an intentional grounding call right here. As the pass protection breaks down, we just showed you the graphic. Michigan first in the Big Ten at quarterback sacks. Now, if there had been somebody close with a number, an eligible receiver, but there was nobody around. The only white jerseys were offensive linemen. John Nealon, standing right behind the quarterback, as the referee should have made that call.
That's a former quarterback, a Hall of Famer talking. Second down and 10. Dante Lee up the middle.
Okay, by Dante Lee.
That'll put him at the 44-yard line and make it third down and about six. And J.J. Grant getting up a little gingerly.
You know, we talked about Eisman being the leader for Ohio State defensively. That man right there, J.J. Grant, unquestionably the leader for the Michigan defense. Fifth-year senior, was hurt a little bit earlier this year, missed a few ball games, is now back. Had knee surgery last year and was out two or three games this year because of that same knee.
Third and six from the 44. Jim Palmer in motion, Greg Fry back. Gets it down the middle to Palmer, and Palmer's got just enough for the first down at the Michigan 48-yard line. Eric Anderson and J.J. Grant make the tackle, but that's good connection there between the quarterback and the tight end.
And Palmer made a nice reception. You know, Ohio State has had a lot of injuries. Palmer is playing because of the injury earlier this year. I think it was the first or second ball game of the year with Jeff Ellis. They thought Ellis was going to go on and be the Big Ten tight end, all Big Ten tight end. They not only are missing Carlos Snow today, but also an outstanding tight end in
Scotty Graham, the fullback, pops it over the middle. Big gain, 12 yards. Down close to the 36.
And the last four or five plays are the sequence that Ohio State and Jim Coletto, their offensive coordinator and play caller, wants to see. Picks the run and the pass, throw on first down, make something happen out of it. There's Coletto. And then that'll loosen up the linebackers and defensive line so you can make some rushing yardage.
Sylvester Stanley, number 60, a freshman out of Youngstown, Ohio, is in, replacing Mike Evans. Evans is the pass rusher. Stanley is the rock on the running defense, and they figure Ohio State's going to run here on first down from the Michigan 36. Dante Lee finds a big hole on the right side. You know who threw a big block in that play? Was that number three, Greg Beatty, the 175-pound split in.
A
he got the block, but he got in the way.
Well, there were two good blocks by skilled players, as you might say. Here he is out here, the wide receiver blocking here. Watch the fullback as he blocks on Abrams as he comes in, and he's just going to go outside the block of the fullback. The play is supposed to go inside, but Lee, he's just a true freshman. He's not so sure he's got the quickness to get around. And also Beatty, number three, occupied the cornerback long enough to get downfield.
So we've played one, and Michigan leads Ohio State 7-0. The Ohio State Buckeyes have had more than a minute to huddle with the coaches. When time was running out at the end of that quarter, the Ohio State offensive unit as a group just hustled right over to the sidelines. They actually got about a minute and 25 seconds of free time to go talk to Jim Coletto. It's the 24-yard line of Michigan, and it's a first down. Threat developing here by the Buckeyes. Fry maybe checking off, stood up, shouted something to his tight end, fakes the pitch out, gives it back to his fullback. Michigan defense will not let Scotty Graham get around the corner. Bobby Abrams and David Key, who play the boundary side defensively for Michigan, kept him sliding along until he ran out of real estate. Let's pause 5 seconds here so our ABC stations can identify themselves. Just inside the 24 now. All at second down and 9. Fry gives to Lee, and Lee goes down right around the 25-yard line. Mike Teeter, number 91, and Eric Anderson, 37. Actually, Fry almost fell down because I think the guard stepped back a little bit to initiate his movement, and they almost tripped each other.
First quarter stats. He must be saying, look at the bottom category, time of possession. If Ohio State is to win this ball game, they're going to have to dominate in that category. One turnover by Michigan did not produce any points.
They're now looking at third down, 11. Biggest pass here. Thrown through the hands of Dante Lee, thrown very hard and high. Now, in the tape that I've been looking at on Ohio State, Bob, Greg Fry has been running around a lot of movement. So far today, he's pretty much straight back.
They show a lot of sprint draw action, a lot of sprint pull up behind the offensive tackles and throw the football. They normally only have about 5 or 6 drop back passes per game. I think he's already reached that limit here today.
42-yard try coming now by Pat O'Mara. Dutchie Point is at it. He lines it up. He crouches. His eyes glitter, and he has it partially blocked. No good. Side call against Michigan.
They've been doing it all year. The two men for Michigan in the middle of your screen. Murray, Beta Murray, 27, and Welburn, number 3. I think Murray gets another one.
Yeah, got his right hand on it.
I think that's 5 block kicks for Murray this year. And in fact, in 2 different ball games, let's take a look at it from the side. From the left side of your screen, we're coming to your picture right there. Like Murray got it. 2 times this year he's had an interception, a fumble recovery, and a block kick in the same ball game.
In 1975, we were undefeated going into the Michigan game. We were rated number 1, and we moved it in and scored. And tied the game 14-14. And Michigan got a little desperate because what was at stake was the Rose Bowl again. My younger brother Ray picked off one of the passes, and he took it down to the 3-yard line. And Pete Johnson, he took it in on the next play, and we took the lead 21-14, and it sent us out to the Rose Bowl.
Watch the Ohio State defense now. You explain it, Bob.
They line up an eye because they shift one side or the other depending on the way Michigan comes out. They key on the tight end. They have defenders that line up to the tight end side and some that go away from it. So they line up an eye. So traffic problem. Traffic condition.
Taylor gives it to Horde. And Horde from the 25 out across the 30. Here's Mike Adamley.
Keith, one man who knows all about the emotions and intensity of the game is former Ohio State All-American and Lombardi Award winner 2 years ago, Chris Spielman. Put it in perspective for us. I know you're on the team bus this morning. What's this game mean to everybody?
Well, I think the way I thought about it when I played is that I considered it an honor and a privilege to be a part of this game. And I've been in Pro Bowl now 2 years, and Pro Bowl is nothing compared to the feeling you get for this game. It's something special, and you really have to play in it and experience it to know what it means.
Taylor gives to Horde. Oh, great play by Eisenman. He didn't make the tackle, but he sure did open the door for Steve Tovar.
Tovar was right there, too. Tovar is a true freshman and was right there to make the play.
Go ahead, Mike.
Chris, I noticed you've been talking to some of the Ohio State linebackers. What kind of advice have you been giving them?
Well, they're asking me, what am I seeing out there? And I'm saying, well, guys, just get off your block and get to the ball. That's all I can say. They're doing a good job, and I'm proud of them.
That's what this game has always been about, old-fashioned football.
It certainly is.
Chris, good luck, and congratulations on the Thanksgiving Day win.
Hi, Steph.
Chris Spielman.
Third down.
Timeout, Michigan.
Timeout by the Wolverines with 12 minutes and 36 seconds to go in the first half. Third down and 6 for the Michigan Wolverines. The ball just short of the 30-yard line. Michigan leading 7-0 over Ohio State. Buckeyes may be offside. I think Spellman got a little bit of an early start, but on a free play, Taylor zeroes in on McMurtry. The catch made at the 44. Good for a first down. Here's John Nealon. Here was Spellman, number 99, who came flying across. He's going to make mistakes.
Have an offside on the defense, decline, first down.
But before he's done, he's going to make a ton of big plays. If he stays healthy. First down for
Michigan. Here's a look at the true freshman.
Look at the neck.
18 years old. Says he tough to find shoes. He has to order special ordering. Gives a lot of business to the big shops, the big men shops around Columbus.
Producer Bob Goodrich said, how many times have you seen a shoe is the same size as the same number as his age? I never have.
And his neck.
Yeah.
And they say he has huge hands. That's one of the things that was really amazing to some of the players that were on the Ohio State team is how large his hands are.
That's offside, and it's on Rich Frimmel of Ohio State. He's a young sophomore from North Olmsted, Ohio. Buckeyes playing a lot of very young people. Two reasons. One is they're talented, but the main reason is so many of the old folks are hurt.
They're just hurting. This is correct. Look at his hands. They say he's got huge hands.
All right, it's first down and 5 for Michigan, and it's midfield. And it is Bunch. And Bunch is a load, 240 pounds. Talking with Coach Schembechler yesterday about this youngster, Spellman. Bo had this comment on him.
He has amazing feet and quickness for a guy that big. You look at him and you say, well, he's played out of position. He should be an interior defensive lineman. But he's got tremendous athletic ability. He's going to be a dominant force in this league defensively.
This is Leroy Horde coming around the corner to the 40-yard line, pick up a 4 penalty flag down. And it might hurt the Wolverines in this instance. That's a 1AA playoff there between Villanova and Georgia Southern. It's going to go against Ohio State. So the Buckeyes hurting themselves here. Moves the football down to their 35. It's a yard short of a first down. Dayton leading Millikan in playoff. 1AA, 2 and 3 playoffs all starting this week. I was going to say, in looking at the Georgia Southern score, how remarkable it is. What the job that Irk Russell has done at down in Statesboro at Georgia Southern. I mean, they were not a factor. And Irk went down there and turned that thing into a winning place in a hurry.
He had an opportunity to go some Division I schools,
he did,
too,
sure
didn't
he?
Did.
Yeah. Well, he was
Georgia. Wasn't Georgia
the defensive athlete? Coordinator for Vince Dooley at Georgia for years and years and years. A true, genuine character of college football. That penalty that was just marked off was a face mask call against Ohio State. And now we're ready on first and one. How many times have you seen a first and one after penalties? Michael Taylor turns the corner, fumbles the football. Ohio State dives for it, and I think they've got it. Duke, second turnover. David Brown covers it. Last time Brown knocked it loose, this time Brown recovers it.
In 10 ball games this year, Michigan had only lost 6 fumbles. They've already lost 2 in the first half of this ball game. And as we mentioned, it's keeping Ohio State in the ball game. Knocks it out right there. That's Eisenman that hit him.
And on that hand that he hit him with, he carries a broken thumb. And I mean a badly broken thumb. And so the Buckeyes get the ball at their own 22. And it's still a 7-0 ball game. Fry gives to Lee. Lee finds some room in the middle. Welborn coming up out of the secondary. He and Murray have to make the hit on him just short of the 30-yard line. The University of Michigan Wolverine defending national champions in basketball on the road to Springfield, Mass. Today, where they're playing Lute Olson's Arizona Wildcats. Wildcats are highly touted, but Brian Williams, who had been expected to be one of the principals for the Wildcats, has had a stress fracture, and he's not quite in form to start the season as yet. We'll see how it goes right after a football game today here on ABC Sports. Fry back, a little play action down the middle. Great play for Palmer, the tight end, and a first down for the Buckeyes. Big Jim Palmer, a senior from Loudonville, Ohio.
One of the things that they do in college ball, when you play a zone coverage, sometimes you vacate it. Here's Welborn. He's going to blitz, but he's going to leave this area of the field open. The tight end is going to come across the field and catch the ball, and Welborn will be picked up in the backfield. Play action to his left. The lineman coming out sees him. Now look where the tight end come, right where Welborn vacated the zone.
So Palmer continues to be a very pleasant surprise for Ohio State in the loss of Ellis. He's played well. Here's Fry rolling it out. Gets daylight, buys time, gets his pass away, and it's low intended for Jeff Graham.
Just a poor throw, and Fry knew it. He was outside the pocket, had good vision with his receiver, didn't have to worry about any protection, and just threw the ball in the ground.
Go, let's go! 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 Let's go! Go! Go!
It's a hard thing to do, Bob. Now, you've quarterbacked at every level of life. When you're running at that speed, trying to throw a football 20 yards on target,
well,
it's hard.
you use your speed to get out there, but then when you get out there ready to throw it, you kind of throttle it down a little bit, and then from repetition in practice, you can make that throw as easy as you can standing in the pocket.
Dante Lee isn't going anywhere. Teeter and Anderson bring him down, but I think in that instance, and probably one of the things that a lot of college quarterbacks haven't learned yet, is to choke your motor just a little bit going outside.
No question. Look at Anderson, 37, as he plays off the block there of Coles. Anderson leads this team coming into the ball game in tackles.
Well, I think there's another one headed for All-American status.
Well, he's
a matter of time.
He's an outstanding player. His father played pro football. His grandfather played pro football. He was a running back in high school, switched to linebacker at Michigan.
He has seven tackles today. Back goes Fry. Straight back. Good protection. Now runs out of time. Won't last forever. Not with people like Mike Evans and Alex Marshall hunt you. Ohio State gave him time to have a look around, so I guess you could call that a coverage sack. Bowman the punt. 38-34 on his first two today. Get a little heat on him, but he gets it away, and it takes a bounce for Welburn. Trip ball bobbles a bit. Whoa! You don't think he is a tough guy? The ball is down. It is down. No fumble. Ohio State calling it. But he, Welburn, turned that thing upfield, and there was nothing but white shirts around him. And he put two of them flat on their back, and I mean he really put a hat on number one of Ohio State, Lance Price.
Let's go back to that last play before the punt. Ohio State passing. Let's go ahead and run it. Now watch Fry. Look at the secondary as he's looking downfield. Now if you stop it right there, look at the receivers that he has to choose from. Covered, covered, covered. These two guys back here are just out to help. This man is covered. Now Marshall is here. Go ahead and run the rest of it now. Watch Marshall. He's got to be able to feel when you're covered downfield and nobody's going to uncover, then you've got to take off and run. You can't ask those offensive linemen to protect you for too long.
When you have that kind of performance on first down, almost always, even with turnovers, it equals W.
Well, Bo is happy with the production. The only thing he's not happy with are the two turnovers, and he said, we were talking to him yesterday, that mistakes are going to be a big part of it.
This is Horde. Leroy Horde. Powerful leg. The man is really strong. And he's out to the 35, and he's playing with a very sore rib cartilage.
The Buckeyes' game plan coming in was to control the tempo of the game with the running game. They have not done it, but Michigan has done it for them. They have controlled the ball, and then when they get down in Ohio State territory, they've fumbled it. So in effect, with the turnovers, the game has stayed close for Ohio State.
8.5 minutes to go in the first half. This is fun. Bunch will go for about 8 yards on the carry. Again, to bring you up to date on what can happen here, recapping what we said at the outset. If Michigan wins, they repeat as champions and go to the Rose Bowl. Nobody's done it since 65-66, Michigan State. If Ohio State wins here today and Illinois wins against Northwestern, Illinois goes to the Rose Bowl because they beat Ohio State. But if Northwestern should upset Illinois and Ohio State win here today, then the Buckeyes would go. So that is your Rose Bowl scenario on this last week of Big Ten football. Call it second down and two. And this is Bunch again. Ashtabula, Ohio is his hometown, and the big junior has got a first down for Michigan.
Bunch missed some time earlier in the year also with a knee injury. Michigan has had a few injuries, but they've come at times where they've had the depth to really come in and take care of that position. Bunch has come back Taylor has been hurt. He's come back. And now with Bowles being hurt, Leroy Horn slides over. And they really don't miss a beat. They've got so much depth at that position.
Off the 47. Wolverines first down. Punch again. Told you he was a load. When he gets it in gear, and he was a principal figure in that clinching drive at Illinois. He slammed for about 11 yards there. Watch the Illini get in action. They haven't kicked off down there yet. And Jack Arood is there to keep an eye on the game for us, and we'll have some reports for you on the progress of that ball game as the day wears on. First down for the Wolverines now, and they're starting to look like they're going to flex their muscles. They've fumbled it away twice, but they've been in scoring position. They lead 7-0. They have a first down at the Ohio State 42. This is Horde. This is what makes Horde so tough, is you get your first contact on him, but he hasn't surrendered on first contact, ever. And he's got such strong legs and thighs that he can just break your grip. And he's run 13 times so far in the game in the first half today, and he's picked up already 83 yards.
Number 58 there is Steve Tovar, true freshman. He's playing for Herman, who was injured earlier. Born and raised in Ohio, wore a Michigan t-shirt every day for 3 months prior to committing to the University of Michigan. And he said, well, I'll visit Ohio State, and he changed his mind. A lot of recruits come out of Ohio. A lot of guys know each other on the field.
Bunch with the ball, Jefferson back in his tailback, and Jared Bunch.
Well, that didn't look pretty. He got bent back, just
yeah,
hoped
sure
that
did.
His leg was freed, and it was.
82, Jay Cook and Steve Tovar were the two people that got him, but Tovar weighs 230 and Cook weighs 220, so 450 versus 240. I reckon 450 ought to win. Have a look at that basketball game that follows football today, and Roger's going to be talking with Andre Weir of Houston. Guess what they will talk about. Trophy. This is Horn. Oh my gosh. I mean, they are really blowing them off the ball right now, Bob.
Well, what they're doing, what Bo is doing, is reestablishing control of this game. He has had control. They fumbled the ball twice. Now he said, hey, we're going to go out there and run the football, and we're not going to drop it. We're going to get it in the end zone. He's retaking the possession of this game.
Second down and one from the Ohio State 21. See, Horde is on pace for a 200-yard day. This possession has been all on the ground. Punch again. This time, Jared has stood up at the 20. He'll pick up a yard, and that's all. And the man that did a lot of the standing up was Derek Eisenman, 10, and number 94, Derek Foster.
Early in the year, excuse me, Keith, I was just going to say this offensive, this defense of Ohio State was ranked 10th in the conference. They have since moved up to 6th, but as we mentioned earlier, it's still a problem area. John Cooper knows that you have to have a tough defense to win the Big Ten, and says this defense will be better next year.
Wishbone set, third and one. And Jared Bunch going up over the top is going to have, I think, the first down. Looks like he got a friendly mark on it. Well, Ohio State is outsized, no question, in the trenches from a defensive perspective. But I'll tell you, they got some pluck. They don't give up easily. They'll measure.
Time for a measurement.
Well, this is just an attitude play with Bunch, the defensive and offensive lineman. Looks as though he tried to go over the top. Ohio State looked as if they had pretty good penetration, but it's a first down for Michigan.
When you got 240 pounds coming over the top, I can put a crick in your neck if you hit him head on.
And the eye back. the fullback in that I formation is normally the blocking back, and Bunch at 240, 41 pounds is normally that, but both Ford and Taylor have fumbled, so Bowles says, let me give it to that big fullback.
Taylor keeps it. I think that will go down as a broken play. Taylor now has 33 yards on the ground, Bunch 40 and Horde 92, and I think they expected Leroy to come up the middle, and he was going wide, and Michael said, oops.
Well, it was a run all the way. It was a quarterback sweep, if you will. Zizekovic on the outside just got upfield, turned the play in, and the rest of the defense for Ohio State made the play.
Horde is out now, and I think somebody is saying, ahem, where were you going on that last play? Jefferson in at the I back. Jefferson with the ball. Stretches inside the 15 to the 13. And Pat Thomas from Centerville, Ohio, gets the tackle. Here's Mike Adamley.
Keith, fans may have noticed the absence of outside linebacker for the Ohio State Buckeyes, Alonzo Spellman. He is not injured. He's simply not ready to play right now. We talked about his great athletic talent. He's also very inexperienced, and he's been kind of messing up some of his assignments, to put it bluntly. So Coach John Cooper has pulled him aside for a bit.
And that's smart to do that. Freshman, a little excited, first time in Michigan Stadium. Pull him out, let him settle down.
Third down and three, Taylor quarterback draw. First down to the 1 yard line. David Brown stopped the touchdown.
As a look at it from the end zone, the guard there, 69, watch Elliott. He's going to set up for a minute. Now he's going to lead Taylor through that gaping hole. Horde gets a block on Tovar. Elliott finishes his block. Brown finally makes a tackle at about the 2 yard line. It's always a good play inside the 10-yard line. Quarterback draw.
First and goal from the 2 for Michigan. Horde back in. Jefferson bounces outside. Touchdown. Yards, 6 points.
13 runs, no passes.
No passes.
It's a Bowles type of football, isn't it? He retook control of the field.
The old-fashioned way.
General Schimpen.
Carlson's kick is good. 2 minutes and 23 seconds to play in the first half. 14-0, Michigan. I think those glasses that young lady has on there in the middle with the red one and the green one could do something to you.
I think she's just trying them out for California. If they go out to the Rose Bowl.
Yeah, I guess. As what we told you a while ago, all of that entire drive was on the ground. No passes. All right, it's Dante Lee and Bobby Olive back for the Buckeyes, and Carlson has a high hanger. And Lee finally gets control of it, almost pops out of there with it, and gets a nice return out to the 32-yard line. So the Buckeyes will go to work with 2 minutes and 18 seconds to play. And tonight, Colombo goes to work with a man who got himself in trouble with too many women. Murder situation. Peter Falk starring in the season premiere of Colombo on the ABC Saturday Mystery following Mr. Belvedere and the Living Dolls tonight on ABC.
I wonder if he got himself a new raincoat.
No. He did have to swap cars, though. I think that a little coupe he was driving, I think absolutely collapsed on the back lot. First down from the 32 as Fry steps back and hums it. Bullet complete. Caught by Jeff Graham, 84. First down, Ohio State at the Michigan 49. So a big play to get him on the Michigan side of the field at 2:10 to go in the first half. And a touchdown here, even a field goal here, would be a big factor in the Buckeye morale going to the clubhouse. Tyrone Harrison is in at fullback now, and Scotty Graham is the tailback for the Buckeyes. Lee getting some rest if he's not dinged up. That pass is thrown well down to the Michigan 26-yard line to Bryant Stabline. That's the second time that Bryant Stabline have hooked up on that pattern.
Well, here the coverage is double zone. Watch it. As the two corners will stay, the two safeties will go back deep. Stabline is here. He's just going to come up and run to the outside behind him. And Fry will make a good throw. Receiver releases inside. The corner kind of hangs because he sees the tight end. And the ball is thrown very well.
First down on the Michigan 26. And Scotty Graham inside the five. First and goal, Buckeyes. So they have come storming back.
Three plays, John Cooper's Buckeyes. Two passes on first down. Davidson, number 50, gets a good block. Harrison blocks out on the linebacker. And Scotty Graham, number 35, who was the fullback most of the season due to the injuries, scoots back the tailback and gets him down inside the 5-yard line.
First and goal from the four. The Buckeyes have taken umbrage to the circumstance, and Greg Fry turns around and says to John Nealon, "Can't hear, sir." You should always say sir when you are speaking reverentially to the man in the striped shirt.
When you're asking for some help.
That's right.
Sir, I can't hear. Would you please grant me an official timeout?
Scotty Graham stays in there at the tailback position. Dante Lee is all right. In fact, he started in and was whistled back off the field. So it's not an injury factor. Moe's out on the field now. Coach Imbeck was out saying to the crowd at that end of the stadium, quiet, let's get on with it. It really isn't that noisy.
Doesn't appear to be, but he's awfully close to that closed end zone.
All right, we'll go with it. Fry gets it, gives it to Graham. Graham fires into the middle, and he'll have a yard. That'll do it. I mean, there are some very large, angry people swapping paint down in the trenches. When you look at Coles and Moxley and Beatty and Davidson and Stasniak, and then you put in Teeter and Hutchinson.
Well, and all the rest. Michigan doesn't give up running yards very easily. In fact, they're first in the Big Ten, fourth nationally against the run. The throw, this is the down.
Yep, second down and goal from the three. Give it to Scotty Graham. Trip Wellborn, number three, is at the bottom. He's the man that locked the legs.
But when you're a running team, you dominate the offensive line like Ohio State has done, the defensive line. You try to run it even inside, and Wellborn does it again.
Ohio State calls a timeout, trying to get something on the scoreboard. All right, the question is whether or not Michigan is going to let Ohio State cross the goal line. That point there is about to be sorely tested, isn't it?
Well, they haven't played Michigan. Michigan defense has something to say about the opponent scoring on them also. Only had 5 touchdowns rushing against Michigan's defense this year.
For Jeff Graham and broken up by Todd Blake.
The left side is just one on one. It's a fade route. The man Graham sees it. Blake, who is playing for Lance Dott, and he's a backup, gets up there at the right time and makes the play.
Pat O'Mara from the 20. It'll be from the 10, so it's a 20-yarder. He had one blocked earlier by Veda Murray of 42 yards. Gets this one up quickly and makes it. And so they do get something out of it. But the impact of points on the scoreboard diminished considerably by the fact that they had it first and goal inside the 5 and had to settle for 3.
Here's that field goal. Look at the 2 safeties for Michigan. McMurray, number 27, almost blocks it again. Almost. Look at what between them.
And you've got 25 seconds remaining in the first half of play.
But your point is well taken. John Cooper's Buckeyes only scoring 3 points. It's almost a victory, a successful drive or a stoppage of a drive for Michigan.
Yep. I think they profit more from it. To have it down there first and goal inside the 5 and not really come close.
I can hear Schembechler's halftime speech already. Last year at Columbus, and these two teams played 20-0. Michigan was ahead of Ohio State. Ohio State came back in the second half. They ran up over 350 yards in total offense, went ahead in the fourth quarter, and John Coulter had to make that great catch late in the ballgame to win it for Michigan.
Desmond Howard is number 21. Allen Jefferson is number 28. They are the deep people for the Wolverines. Timeouts remaining, both with 2. Rolls it down the middle of the field. It's slapped down and picked up and returned by Bernie Leggett, a fullback. Now Michigan takes possession at their own 34 with 20 seconds remaining on the clock. Prudential halftime report with Roger Twybell. And what they'll be doing, plus scores of games that are going on. So Michael Taylor comes out now. And see whether or not he wants to load up the long rifle and try for something. Or whether they'll just take the 14-3 lead and go to the clubhouse. Well, he's going to spend the timeout right here. So Michigan will talk some more before the final plays of the half. Flea flicker time?
I think you got 2 of the best receivers in the Big Ten. It's time you're on your own, 34-yard line. Get the receivers downfield, fire it down there. Maybe you'll come up with a catch and get an opportunity to kick a field goal. 20 seconds to go in the half.
Callaway and McMurtry now. That's Greg number 1 and Callaway number 2. They're on the same side. But Chris and Greg are going to send Callaway the other way. McMurtry's on the fly. They go down the middle for Walker, the tight end, and a first down at the 43-yard line of Ohio State and stop the clock with 14 seconds. Well, sending those 2 wideouts on fly down the sidelines opened up the middle wide open for Walker.
And the play action held the linebacker. The play action held the linebacker enough to get Walker open. Watch, the receivers are going to go straight down. Here's Walker right here as he goes down here and hook. Watch this linebacker. When the play action is in effect, the linebacker is really held, first of all, and then he doesn't get over to his coverage. And Walker is right open in the middle of the field. Headed down in good shape, 14 seconds remain.
Yeah, but I don't. They just spent their last time out. Michigan did.
Well, you throw it deep. You got 14 seconds. You throw it deep for the end zone, or down and deep down and out to stop the clock on an out of bounds and get your field goal team in there. You don't
just
have time.
Just when J.D. Carlson was about to become famous, and we were about to give him a nickname, something akin to the nature of a string of unblemished field goals. He missed one last week. Had his string snapped at 12.
What was the nickname you had picked out for him?
Well, I hadn't really decided. I started out with Calhoun, and we're going to work from there.
Calhoun Carlson.
Well, J.D. Carlson sounds like chairman of the board.
Sure
now,
he can be that
a few years from now.
He looks too young to be a chairman of the board.
He's a cute youngster.
Well, he certainly took over and solved one of Schembechler's big problems coming into the year. Mike Gillette was their kicker and punter last year. Talking with Bo before the season, his biggest concern was his place kicking and his punting. Carlson is certainly taking care of the place kicking.
Ball is at the 42 of Ohio State now. 14 seconds. And Michigan with no more timeouts. Taylor's pass to the sidelines, an incomplete intended for Derek Walker, the tight end. Now they're down to 10 seconds. You might need a little more, huh? Maybe another 10 yards?
Well, I don't fault throwing the short crossing route, but not to a guy like Walker, who's 250. Throw it to one of your backs out of the backfield. Man coverage on the play. If he breaks the tackle, he can run for some yardage and then get out of bounds. Walker, he ain't going to outrun anybody.
The wind is, if the flags mean anything, Bob, the wind's going to be in their face for a kick. Taylor gets it off. That's in the crowd. And you got 3 seconds. So now you got to go ahead, I guess, and try for it. The long in Carlson's career, his long field goal is 48. That's his longest.
Well, he's not going to kick a field goal here.
He can't kick it from here.
They just throw the ball into the end zone and hope for some luck on an alley-oop pass.
That's not a very good sequence, is it? This particular, the last sequence of plays have not been particularly effective.
Well, they haven't. Remember, this is Michigan is not a pro-style passing attack. They're
seems uncertain for me.
Out of bounds. That was McMurtry. He was trying to go to McMurtry to get bumped out of bounds.
So Taylor takes it out of bounds, and time has run out, and at halftime it's 14-3, Michigan leading Ohio State. We'll be back with a potential halftime report after this message and a word from our ABC station. At halftime, it's 14-3. The Michigan Wolverines leading at home over Old Foe, Ohio State. Here, the University of Michigan marching band, Jerry Luckhart conducting. Wake up.
I was over here looking at my stuff.
The switcher has frozen. It has gone kaplunked.
Well, we'll get it fixed.
We'll try. Let's talk about the first half of play and some of the things that happened in the first half and some of the things that almost happened and didn't. First off, the scoring circumstance for Michigan, the two turnovers kept it from really kind of getting out of hand.
Well, and we talked in the opening that Ohio State needed to get some turnovers to stay in the ball game. They got the two turnovers from Michigan, but they didn't do anything with them. And as you mentioned, if Michigan hadn't fumbled, they'd been 28-3 ahead.
getting the touchdown after the first turnover to give him a 7-0 lead. And then, of course, Allen Jefferson ran it in for the second touchdown to make it 14-0. But I thought the real big series of that whole first half was when Ohio State in three plays go bang, 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 first and goal inside the five and can't do anything with it.
Yeah, it was a big emotional thing for Ohio State to get down there after they were down 14-0, and a big emotional lift for Michigan to hold them to 3 points. But at least Ohio State has something going into the second half. They did score the three.
And so that's where we are at halftime, 14-3, Michigan in the lead. If the Michigan Wolverines can beat the Ohio State Buckeyes today, we will have a rematch in the Rose Bowl, matching Michigan and Southern California. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? Southern California led 14-3 at halftime in the last Rose Bowl, but Michigan, led by Leroy Hoard's MVP performance, came storming back to win it 22-14. Hoard finished with big numbers and may have to be the main man again, since his running mate Tony Bowles has had knee surgery and may miss the Rose Bowl game. Hoard, 142 yards and 2 touchdowns, as Michigan won it. And the teams are back now as we look at the numbers for the first half.
Time of possession, we talked about earlier, needed to be in favor of Ohio State for them to have a chance to win this ball game. It's about even. Total plays about even, although Michigan's run 7 more. And the biggest statistic there, rushing yards for Ohio State, only 85. When they came into the ball game, averaging 245 for the ball game, per game. Individually, for Michigan, their offensive leaders, Taylor is 5 of 9 with 75 yards. Hoard leads the rushers with 92 yards and 14 carries, and McMurtry has 2 receptions. State defensively, Tovar, the freshman who replaced the inside linebacker Herman, leads with 8. Brown has 3 tackles and 1 fumble recovery.
And in case you wonder about interest in the old college game, 106,137. It is the 4th largest crowd in Michigan Stadium history. 106,137. And they have been rewarded with an unusually nice day weather-wise on the last Saturday of November.
Offensively for Ohio State, Fry is 5 of 10. He's going to have to do much better in the second half for Ohio State if they have a chance to win. Rushing yards, not bad. But not for Ohio State. They usually get a lot more. And Stabline leads the receivers. Anderson for Michigan leads the tackles with 8.
And we're ready to go with Michigan getting the ball to start the second half. Allen Jefferson 28, Desmond Howard 21 are the deep people. O'Mara hits it for Ohio State. And it's Howard, yard deep in the end zone. Desmond thought he was going to get clobbered at about the 25, so he kind of put his hat down and squared his shoulders, and all of a sudden whoever he was expecting didn't arrive, and he fell for another 10 yards, and finally Tovar brought him down.
Well, Michigan is leading the Big Ten in kickoff returns. They have done a nice job of revamping their special teams after that opening loss to Notre Dame. Their special teams have played very well.
So the Wolverines go to work from their 35-yard line. Michael Taylor, Jared Bunch, Leroy Hoard. Behind Steve Everett at the center, and this is Hoard, who had a big first half. And Leroy will pick up about 4 yards on his first carry of the second half. Again, to recap for you, if Michigan wins, they repeat as champions and go to the Rose Bowl. If Michigan should lose to Ohio State, Illinois beat Northwestern, Illinois would go to the Rose Bowl. If Ohio State should beat Michigan and Northwestern beat Illinois, then Ohio State would go to the Rose Bowl. Second down and six. Taylor, play action, goes for McMurtry. Intercepted by Vinny Clark, a junior from Cincinnati. Third turnover for the Michigan Wolverines.
There's an out pattern at the bottom of the screen. Clark, number seven, is inside. He sees it, reads the pattern very well, goes for the interception, and makes an outstanding catch. It's his third interception of the year. And as Keith mentioned, the third turnover. Things are going pretty well for Ohio State in the turnover area. They just need to convert some of those turnovers into points.
Hitch and go is six, isn't it?
That's for sure. And that'll be the next thing they try on Clark, believe it.
Scotty Graham opens the second half at tailback. Not at fullback, but at tailback. And Greg Fry steps back, trying to cash in, chips early. Gets the pass away to Fady. It's a big play to the 32-yard line of Michigan. 14-3 is your score. But a quick touchdown here. And my gosh, Bo will be remembering last year for sure.
Well, I'm sure that John Cooper also mentioned that, hey, we did it last year. We weren't down as many points as we were last year. We're only down 11 points. Let's go out, play second half ball. And Fry's got to have a good half, second half for them to win this game.
And Michigan helping Ohio State with that third turnover. Buckeyes stop first down inside the Wolverine 32. And Scotty Graham up the middle. That's the same play that put him first and goal inside the five, and they had to settle for three. He got 9 yards on that carry. So somebody on that side of center is doing a pretty good job, and that somebody would be Moxley, 310 pounds, and Coles, 295 pounds. 2 years ago, Tim Moxley, number 74's dad, had a heart attack in the stands here, and he saw his dad being taken out on a stretcher. Of course, that tended to unsettle one's mind when you see your father go out a victim of a heart attack. But his dad is back today and in the stands watching the game. Is out now, and Dante Lee checks in at the tailback position for Ohio State. But it's Scotty Graham getting the ball again, and Scotty disappears in the crowd on second down and one. He will have to wait until somebody puts a foot down and gives him a spot. It looks all right for the first down. 13:09 remaining in the third quarter, and Michigan leading 14-3. And it is a first down. Ball at the Michigan 21. State line, 88 checks in at a wideout, and Harrison is back in at fullback, putting Scotty Graham back at tailback. Graham's a 225-pounder, so if he gets a little momentum going, he can hit you a lick.
He gives him some experience at that position.
He's got the ball, bounces outside. He's not a bad-looking tailback, is he? Ball goes to the 10.
He was a tailback in high school, and because of all the tailbacks that they had this year at the beginning of the season, and Snow and Bryant. Take a look at Anderson, number 37, the leading tackle of the first half. That's Davidson, number 50, the left guard, pulling, getting around. And that's why Graham had such a nice run, that Anderson was on his back.
Yeah, well, Davidson weighs 305, and Eric weighs 235.
Yep. So
that's a lot, 70 pounds. Donnie Lee is back in now at tailback. First down. Ball is just a fraction outside the 10-yard line, and Scotty Graham running in traffic will have about three. That'll be his 14th carry, and right about 80 yards. Anderson. Art Beattie comes in, probably bringing a play. And with Beattie comes Harrison. That moves Graham again to the tailback position.
Let's see if they throw on second down here, Keith. It's tough to run on Michigan inside the 10.
Ball is near the 7. Somebody's stubborn. Tell you.
Well, you know, you're right. I mean, you're passing up all these good running downs, trying to run on a team that doesn't give up much yardage, but you got to know where John Cooper and Jim Coletto, the offensive coordinator, have come from. They've seen this team all year. They know they can run. They can run anywhere on the field against anybody. At least that's the way they feel. And today it isn't working inside the 10-yard line against Michigan.
You can get a first down here by a hair on your chinny chin chin, but not by much. So it is literally third down and 5, not goal. And they're throwing on third down, and it's batted down by Mike Teeter. Big number 91 just stood up there and slapped it away, and it's fourth down, and they'll have to settle for the field goal try. I gotta believe you gotta move Fry.
Yeah,
you got to run him. You got to circle him.
Get him outside the pocket. You got more ways to hurt you. You won't have people knocking passes down. Linebackers won't be in between you and receivers if you're outside the pocket.
Pat O'Morrow. This will be his third. He was good from 20. Blocked at 42, and now is trying from 22. And he gets it. So at 10 minutes and 46 seconds to go in the third quarter, and we got a penalty flag. Hold the phone. Hold the phone. It's against Michigan. You never take points off the scoreboard. 14-6, 10:46 to play in the third quarter. All right, John Cooper. Got to be a little frustrated. Let me tell you this about the last four Ohio State possessions. They've driven to the Michigan 25, had a field goal blocked. Then they punted. Then they went to the Michigan 3, settled for 3 points. Then went to the Michigan 5, and settled for 3 points. Ohio State will be kicking off from the 40-yard line after that penalty against the Wolverines on the fourth try, with Desmond Howard and Allen Jefferson deep, and Pat O'Mara kicking off. Pat is a senior from Radford, Virginia. 14-6 ball game now. Wolverines lead. And 10:46 to go in the third quarter. Ball's way back there in the end zone. Very high, very good hanger, and there'll be no return. See the Michigan offensive unit coming out. Steve Everett's 51, Matt Elliott 69, Greg Skrepanak, the big man, at 75, Dean Dinkman 78, Tom Doring 73. Derek Walker remains the tight end. The wideouts are Callaway and McMurtry with Michael Taylor pulling the trigger in front of Bunch and Horn. On the option, Horn gets it, turns back inside, and runs in to number 99, Alonzo Spellman.
The 99 is Spellman. That's the man we've been talking about in the first half. Option right at him, forces the pitch to Hord, and then has enough foot speed to get down the line. And when Hord cuts back, he is there for the tackle.
That man is 6'6, 255 pounds, and a baby.
That's right.
True freshman. Ball is at the 19-yard line. And it's second down, 11. Leroy again. Outside he goes. Block on the corner. Well, he blocked him, and his arrival didn't exactly jive, but he got something out of it anyway. Ran away from Steve Tovar to pick up about 6 yards on the play. And somebody's, that's Hort, ganging up. Remember, he's been playing now with very sore rib cage. Apparently a cartilage bruise. Very, very sore, and that may very well be what it is that is keeping him down for the moment. Court has to come out of the game. He's got just gone past 100 yards, and he took a hit. I mean, it was a collision. Listen to it.
Yeah, helmet to helmet. It looked like number 48, Mark Pellini, collided with him. And, you know, sometimes those are just temporary things, and sometimes they take about 2 or 3 hours until you know where you are.
Alan Jefferson is in replacing him as Michael Taylor on third down goes back to throw, goes down the middle with it. The pass is no good. Short hop by Greg McMurtry, but a great try. That was the baseball instincts taking over right there. Illinois has gone to the lead in the first quarter against Northwestern. That game getting underway, 7-0. Illini can only win and hope that Ohio State can handle Michigan, because if Ohio State can, then the Illini with a win go to the Rose Bowl. Chris Stapleton is in to do the punting now for the Wolverines. Straight up in the air. He had some pressure coming, and he just flat missed the kick. I don't believe that anybody got a piece of it.
No, it was not touched.
It went straight up. 15 yards. Let's check in with Roger Twible. 15-yard punt by Stapleton, and Ohio State gets the football first down at the Michigan 40-yard line. Dante Lee comes in at tailback, and that sends Scotty Graham to the sideline. And this is the best starting point Ohio State has had for a possession all day. The Michigan 40.
Go! Go!
And Fry straight back. Down the middle. Tight end Palmer. And is close to a first down. He won't quite have it. He's just short of the 30. Let's check in with Mike Adamley.
Steve, with Tony Bowles out, the Wolverines could ill afford to lose Leroy Horde. Fortunately, he is all right. He sustained just not even a mild concussion, just a little dazed. He'll be back in the ball game.
Well, it wasn't a rib cage, you know?
No.
That's good. That does hurt. Second down, call it one. For Ohio State. Graham is back, Lee's out at tailback. First down by a couple of yards as Michigan drives him back, but he easily picked up his first down.
Ohio State has had the best of it since the second half started. You mentioned that last year they really came back from a big deficit. They're doing the same thing here this afternoon, scoring on their first drive, stopping Michigan on their first drive, and then good field position on the ensuing punt.
28 of Michigan. I just gotta believe if they're gonna score, though, they gotta do something a little differently down here.
Inside the 10, they're gonna have to do something different. Yep. And that's throw the ball.
Graham finds some room on the corner and gets inside the 25 to the 24. And that's a 4-yard pickup. Todd Plate and J.J. Grant are the tacklers for the Wolverines.
You know, they're really hamstrung a little bit, John Cooper and his offense, as we've mentioned. Scotty Graham is their fourth tailback at that position. We mentioned that the snow was out. He was expected to play maybe a little bit today. He's had a knee injury. James Bryan is out. Dante Lee is a true freshman. Doesn't give you a lot of the experience. Sometimes you miss checkoffs, miss blocking assignments. Scotty Graham is there now. He is the normal starting fullback.
Second down and six. Outside again and gets away for the first down. Well, I'll tell you what, Scotty Graham is spending everything he's got. and giving Ohio State a heck of a ball game. With a healthy Carlos Snow now, I tell you, these guys would really be tough.
Well, they've been tough all year. They won six straight coming into the ball game, and they've done it basically with a run first, pass second attack. But that's not going to work against Michigan and their defense. They're going to have to mix the pass in, and that's what they've done here in the second half. See Teeter coming off with some kind of arm or shoulder injury.
And that's Palmer, isn't it? Or who knows? It's,
yeah, 85.
85, yeah, Palmer. The tight end. He's shaking up. Lee is back in at tailback now, and Scotty Graham moves up to fullback. It's a first down for Ohio State at the Michigan 15-yard line. They give it inside to Graham, and he goes to the 9. Got 6 yards. And that's very good offensive surge there by the linemen, Davidson, Beatty, and Coles. And now Scotty Graham goes past 100 yards. He's got 102 on 18 carries.
Earlier this year, three running backs for Ohio State all went over 100 yards. Scotty Graham, Carlos Snow, and Dante Lee.
Well, he's also the second man to run for 100 yards or more against Michigan this season, the other being Darrell Thompson of Minnesota.
Checking off. Up the corner, he's going to blitz. And he does.
And he gives it to Graham, and Graham is down to about the 6-yard line. He's just a little bit short of his first down.
Let's show you why the checkoff. He saw the corner up here. This is key. Edging up. He probably had a play to the right side. He then switched it and changed it where it would come to his left side and avoid nobody being on the blitzing cornerback. You know, you have run checkoffs and you have pass checkoffs. Most people think you just check off two passes. A lot of it is running game.
It's third down and a short yard for Ohio State. Anderson was hunting him and found him, but too late. And he picks up the yard.
Cooper's offense have been down here twice without getting any touchdowns. On both occasions, they ran both on first and second down. Let's see what they do now since they're barely inside the 5-yard line.
Bobby Abrams shaking up a little bit, but he'll stay. In the meantime, Eric Anderson has come off the field. Anderson has hobbled off at the inside linebacker position. Who'd they send out, Milligan or Spencer?
I think you're getting an example of what this game has been down through the years, and that is a very physical, hard-hitting game.
It's Milligan replacing Anderson. First and goal. That's the fullback. Harrison getting his first carry of the day, and the 235-pound junior from Highland Park. They thought they might surprise Michigan and give it to a man who hadn't seen the ball all day, but they really didn't surprise him very much, did they? Michigan took his shoe off. Anderson goes back into the game now, and Milligan comes out. Harrison has to leave for Ohio State to put his shoe on.
This is my best against your best. I'm going to continue to run it. I'm going to show you I can run this ball into the end zone. Schembechler says, no, you can't.
Ryan tries to get a little help from the referee. Won't buy it. The play ball. Fullback. Touchdown, Ohio State.
Still kick a field goal and go ahead. Well, I guess John Cooper and Jim Coletto know more about their offense than we do. They finally kept running, and finally got a rushing touchdown.
And it comes at 4:03 to play in the third quarter, so there's a whole bunch of time left. David Key covers it. So the quarterback, Greg Fry, never got away from center with the ball. And the score stands at 14-12, Michigan.
Up in front of him, started standing up before the snap was completed. Conversion attempt, 95 to the left side of your screen, is J.J. Grant. Both the quarterback, Fry, and the center, Beatty, saw him coming and took their attention off what they were doing just enough that the snap wasn't made correctly. Usually the center, when he sees that coming, will move the block before he completes the snap.
Buckeyes will kick it off now. As soon as we can get the ball back on the tee. Three to go in the third quarter in a two-point ball game. So here we go.
The Cole's got to be saying, here we go again, and all the mishaps.
Right.
Last year.
Omar hits it. It's high and short. And out of bounds. They'll tee it up and kick it again, and we go now.
Out of bounds at the 12.
Back to the 30-yard line where they'll kick it off.
With the wind, I think the reason they're swimming is because Michigan's kickoff returns have been so good of late.
Well, I think they want to kick it to Jefferson too, maybe, and not get it over to Howard. Howard being the faster, though the younger. I don't know why they would want to kick it to a seasoned tailback though, instead of a young wideout. I'm sure they must have a reason. Secondly, O'Mara just simply didn't hit the ball very well, and he was summoned to the sideline and told to tee it up on the other side of the field, go to the other hash mark, which is what he has done.
They've had a problem, Ohio State has this year, with kickoff coverage. They have not allowed any touchdowns to be scored, but they've got a lot of good field position.
High, and again, it's very short. It's going to be Leggett at the 25-yard line. The fullback picks it up, and Bernie comes back to the 35, out to the 36. And let's check in with Jack Arute.
Keith, there's mixed emotions here with the tie between Northwestern and Illinois, but a lot of the fans like Dave Klein are watching your game there in Ann Arbor. In fact, he's got a little Watchman TV, and they're trying to decide whether they want roses or the Citrus Bowl. Which one do you want to go to, Dave?
We want roses. We want to go to Pasadena. Okay, yeah.
In fact, Keith, there are more fans here watching the game from Illinois than there are from the Northwestern side. Let's go back to you.
And the score is 7-7.
You've got to know that the Illinois players looking at that scoreboard, seeing this score,
yeah,
got to be encouraged.
Yeah, but the Northwestern just scored.
Well, maybe they're looking up the scoreboard too much.
This is Jefferson, a big hole for Allen. All the way to midfield. 14-yard pickup and a first down for Michigan. Now let's see if Michigan pulled the chin straps a little tighter and they can just take it and stick it in the end zone. Here comes Horde back. So Leroy's back in the lineup. That's the time remaining, third quarter. Horde with the ball, cuts it back into the middle, and gets taken down with some authority by Rich Frimmel, number 90.
Last year against Ohio State, Horde rushed for 158 yards. Today he has 102 on 18 carries.
But he's getting a little sore. Second down and 9 at the Ohio State 49. This is Munch. And Jared Munch is taken down after a yard pickup. Now the Ohio State defenders are flying to the ball. Tovar, 58 on that tackle. He's a 230-pound freshman from Elyria, Ohio.
He's a young man that really wanted to come to Michigan for a while and then said, well, after I saw Ohio State and thought about all those great linebackers that have played at Ohio State, Steelman and Cousineau, Pepper Johnson, so I think Ohio State has a jersey for me.
Third and eight, Michael Taylor wanted to run a quarterback draw, but they flush him and get him.
Well, there's no question, Keith, that the momentum of this game has switched over to the Buckeyes here in the second half, just as it did last year in the game at Columbus.
Chris Stapleton has checked in now to do the punting. Last time he almost whiffed it, 15-yarder. He needs a little pooch kick here just to get it up in the air. Hits a knuckleball down to the 16, where it is taken by Bobby Olive and returned by Olive to the 25. So he kicked it right to Olive instead of angling for a corner. Two-point ball game here in Ann Arbor with 106,137, the fourth largest crowd in Michigan Stadium history. Michigan trying to repeat as Big Ten champion. Meantime, at Evanston, Illinois has gone to the lead again over Northwestern, 14-7. The ball is the 25-yard line for Ohio State. First down for the Buckeyes with Graham and Harrison in the I formation. Jeff Graham in motion. Scotty Graham, play action, Fry keeping it. They flush him out of the pocket. Greg can't throw it down, son. You got to run with it. And he's taken down up around the 34-yard line. Todd Plate brought him down, and we go to Roger Twible.
Let's go back to the end of this last play. Number 84, Graham, right there on the right of your screen, just levels. I think that's Marshall, 59. It's helping your quarterback out.
Lee in at tailback now. Second down and one. Scotty Graham having a big day and a long day. And as the seconds tick down at the end of the third quarter, it's first down Illini. The Honda Scholar Athlete of the Week, brought to you by American Honda. Proud to support amateur athletics. The award goes to John Jackson, senior flanker, USC. That's Southern California. In last week's 10-10 tie, he caught a pass in his 36th consecutive game, tying a Pac-10 record. John is a graduate student in business, working on his MBA, grade point 3.3, and Honda will present a check for $2,000 to the General Scholarship Fund of the University of Southern California. So after three quarters of play, it is 14-12, Michigan leads Ohio State. We'll be back after this message and the word from our NBC. Well, Nancy.
Who's me?
I'm
you
sure,
got a lot of friends.
I'm sure whoever Mary is, they were told to watch the game. I'm sure she knows.
It's first down for Ohio State. 14-12, Michigan leading. Final quarter of play. Buckeyes, Greg Fry back to throw it. Let's it go to the sideline. Intercepted by Todd Plate. Todd Plate was between a rock and a hard place. He had a receiver in front of him, a receiver behind him, no help in sight. So what did he do? He intercepts it.
Passing on first down. This is what's been working for him in the third quarter. Penetration, people in his face. He had to throw it high. Couldn't see that far. Threw it where he shouldn't have thrown it. There was a defensive man in front of and in back of Graham. First turnover. Watch the pressure here. Marshall, 59, and Grant, 95, right there. That caused the interception as much as anything else.
And it's first down, Michigan at their own 47, leading by 2 points. the shot at their back. And Leroy Horde, trying to make his cut, loses his footing. Tovar takes him down, and here's Mike.
Well, Keith, you remember that Leroy Horde shot he took back in the third quarter. The man who hit him, David Brown, the Buckeyes cornerback, he is out for the rest of the game. He has suffered a fairly severe concussion. Doctors feel that it's in his best interest to keep him out. He's wearing a brace right now, as you can see there, and is being talked to by the doctors, but he is definitely out for the rest of the game. Dave Brown.
Thank you, Mike.
Might have heard him. He's a four-year starter.
Second down and seven. Horde again. That'll be close, depending on the mark again. The front foot, in this instance, the left foot, is the marking foot. And it is short of the first down by a yard. Third and one for the Wolverines. For big yardage.
Well, here it is from behind. The offensive line is just going to block straight. The fullback's going to lead for him, and right through here, it's just nothing fancy. Man on man. Scrappaneck 75. There's nobody for Jefferson to block until he gets to the free safety, Pelini.
Ord is down on the ground right now. Oh, there's a timeout for it.
I'm telling you, every time I threw the ball up in the air, there was a Wolverine there, and it happened to be Barry Pearson. Barry picked off three of them that day, and probably the worst day of my life.
We may have seen the last of Leroy Horde for the day. I mean, he had a hard time coming off the field.
This is after he got through, almost got down into the end zone, and then when you've got sore ribs and sore muscles in there, I'll tell you, he's just playing on determination and guts, but he falls on the ball again. He had some ribs left over from last week, and you just don't get rid of those in 1 week.
All right. You get Vaughn and Jefferson in there with Bunch now on first and goal from the four. That didn't work. Denny Clark on a full blitz came flying through and got a hold of Taylor. So they will lose a bit on that play, back to the six.
When you backed up inside your 5 or your 10 yard line, especially your 5-6 yard line, you play run first. You make sure they don't run, especially on first and second downs. You're going to throw the ball. Those are the best downs to throw it on.
Michael Taylor, I think, got backed into eating that ball. I think somebody might have gone the wrong way, and it might have been Vaughn, but I doubt it. To the corner for Callaway. No, didn't hold it. Callaway against Foster Falk. Had his hands on it.
Looked to me like he should have caught it. The ball was there.
Falk just outfought him.
It's interesting that that's the same pass in the same corner of the end zone that Ohio State tried earlier in the ballgame that was incomplete.
Taylor now.
Well, they know who they were going after, Keith. 22 Falk is a true freshman replacing Brown. There's the ball coming out. And he must not have held on. We can't see the end of it because of the camera.
Taylor's missed the last five.
Freshman is still out here covering McMurtry now.
Third down and goal. Taylor to Bunch. For a touchdown. importance can be attached to this extra point. They make it a 9-point lead instead of just 8.
Look at Jared Bunch. He had only caught 5 passes coming into the ball game, but that was a big touchdown for Michigan. Callaway's going to continue in motion. Here's the tight end. He's going to release inside. He wants to go to him first, but he's covered the back right out of here. He's going to hit him right out in the flat. Good play by the quarterback, Taylor. Watch the tight end release inside. He wants to go to him. He's covered. Comes off of him very quickly to Bunch, and he runs over Clark. Another look at it from the defensive side. Looks to his tight end. He's all over him. Gets the ball quickly out to Bunch, and that's the key. That's why the play worked, because he got him the ball quickly before he was covered by Clark.
Leroy Hoard is still being administered to, and it looks like it might be an ankle sprain.
Well, it's more than an ankle. Even though he's got some ribs.
We know he's got that. All right, J.D. Carlson just hits it a mile high and knocks it downtown, a yard deep in the end zone. Here comes Bobby Olive, and he's cut down at the 20. It's 12-17 to go in a 9-point Michigan lead, and pause here. 5 seconds to allow our ABC stations to tell you who they are.
This is Channel 7, WLS-TV, Chicago.
Let's check in for a moment with Mike.
Well, Keith, the condition of Leroy Hoard, it is not the cartilage in his ribs, it's his left ankle. Leroy says, hey, to the trainers, I can't put any weight on it, I can't put any pressure on it. They're looking at a possible sprain and a possible break, maybe. That would be the worst case scenario. Whoa. But it's his left ankle and not his ribs. He's definitely out for the rest of the game, though.
All right, thank you. Scotty Graham, who's been the bell cow for Ohio State. That pass thrown toward Graham by Fry, and off target. Graham going into the line and then breaking off of the sideline. Couldn't get to it.
Ohio State continues to throw on first down, which is the best way to go. If you complete it, if you go incomplete, then it gets into a passing situations, and that's when it's a little bit tougher to throw against Michigan's defense. Or any defense, for that matter.
Second and 10. From the 20. Graham. And Scotty will have 3, maybe 4, before Trip Welborn brings him down. General Air Force headed for the Liberty Bowl. Boston College and Georgia Tech. Playing a close one, and Georgia Southern now has stretched out its lead to 17 points over Villanova. Look at Montana. Foreman. Eddie Robinson, great Eddie. Still going. One more game than any coach ever. Third down and 7. Underneath, Fry completes it. Jim Palmer tied in, back from injury, and first down, Ohio State at the 42.
There's Palmer right here, and the man covering is Welborn. He's going to start across field. Welborn's going to chase him, and then he comes back this way. It's a good route if you got man coverage. Watch Welborn. He's going across field, takes off, pushes off of him a little bit, comes back, nobody in the area. Man-to-man coverage and a big first down for Ohio State.
And another big injury possibility for Michigan. J.J. Grant, number 95, hobbles off the field.
We've had a number of injuries, haven't we? I bet we've had 7, 8 injuries just in this ball game alone, and they came in banged up.
Dante Lee, the tailback. Scotty Graham moves back up to fullback. Graham searches over the left side for about 3-4 yards. See Joe Stasniak, number 79, getting up hobbling a little bit too. It's kind of interesting to watch Stasniak when he works along the line and a play is made. He goes searching down the line for his little buddies that carried the ball and picks them up.
Always there to pick him up.
Yeah, he's the policeman. Huh? Yeah, he's always there. Big Joe.
Big Joe is right. 6'5 and 290. They call him the quick tackle. Plays on the quick side.
Second and seven. Little option here as Fry turns upfield with it and gets to midfield, and that leaves him about 3 yards short of his first down. See Stasniak right in there, picking him up, toting him back. Illini putting Northwestern away now in the second quarter. Third down and three. Just moved inside 10 minutes to play in the ball game, and Michigan leading 21-12 over Ohio State. Play action, Fry unloads it, pass is good for a first down to Scotty Graham. Graham is taken out of bounds at the Michigan 36-yard line. What a ball game this youngster's played. Scotty Graham, sophomore, 5'10", 225 from Long Beach, New York.
Had a heck of a game last week, too, gaining 152 yards. It's Wisconsin. Graduated from the same high school as Pete Johnson. Another pretty successful fullback at Ohio State. Good play calling, though, Keith. Third and medium, faked it to the tailback and snuck the fullback out in the flat.
Brett Welburn doesn't trip him. He may have scored. Welburn got a piece of him, just enough of him. And it's another first down for the Buckeyes.
We've been talking about Stasniak. Here he is here at the right end. He's on the weak side or the quick side. Watch him as he pulls, and Donnie Lee is going to cut right off of his block. Well, he blocks two guys, takes them out, and the rest is Lee by himself.
Graham, now your tailback. First down, 22-yard line of Michigan. Graham with the ball. Down to the 16. That's about 6 yards. When you can get 6 yards on first down on the ground, well, you just keep on doing it.
Well, what has happened in this game, Keith? The first half, Michigan dominated the first half. Even though they made some turnovers, they dominated. Ohio State came in to, well, we know you're better defensively. We don't know if we can play with you. We went in halftime. They said, all right, this is the last half. Let's just go out and let it hang out. Let it all hang loose and see what happens. They're right in this ballgame, and they believe they can win now. Michigan's got a fight on their hands.
Lee and Graham behind the Fry. Second down, long three. Fullback Graham. That's the first down, just short of the 10.
Tackle by Mike.
Yeah, the big people are now Ohio State threatening to take control of the line of scrimmage, aren't they?
Yeah. Well, the other thing that is happening, the big offensive linemen for Ohio State are just blocking straight most of the time. Occasionally they'll pull. But the backs are doing a nice job of not hitting the hole too quickly, but reading it. If it's not where they expect it to be, they'll slide a little bit to the right or left, and there are some gaps in there.
First and 10, short of the 10-yard stripe. But they can get a first down without scoring. Throwing on first down. Pass is good to Jeff Graham, and he's wrestled down at the 4. Alex Marshall, the backer on that side, number 59, made the tackle.
Going to come right this way. 84 right in your screen. This is a dangerous pass. It covers a long way. You've got to be very careful. There's no defensive man sitting out there that sees the ball along with the receiver.
J.J. Grant is back in. Michigan goes to a goal line defense now, taking Vada Murray out and putting another lineman in.
that's Anderson. He's going to slide to his left. There really aren't any big holes in there. But what's the crack? He slides through. That's good defense and just good running on the part of Graham.
Graham now, 27 carries, 135 yards, and two touchdowns for Ohio State. Omaro for the extra point. Blocked! Tripp Wellborn blocked it.
Well, it's not a big point at this point. Because it's 21-18, so watch here. The man on the left side, number three, gets it this time. Tripp Wellborn. He and Beta Murray. Wellborn was just named to three different All-American teams the last couple of weeks.
Tomorrow had made 64 straight PATs, an OSU record. But Wellborn just broke it.
Big.
Tripp Wellborn. Big play, but Tripp. 21-18 ball game, 7:04 to play.
Well, he's made big plays all year. He's intercepted passes, he has blitzed. In fact, he has three sacks. And that's the first big play he's made as far as blocking the extra point. Now, he and McMurray, Beta Murray, his safety, his sidekick, have a little going argument as to who blocked some of those earlier kicks because they're right there. Yeah. The SID, Bruce Motti here in Michigan, has given most of them to Murray, but Wellborn says, I got a couple of those. And he got one today, and it was a big one.
Omar to kick it off now with Howard and the Jefferson deep. That's a very short kick. And Greg McMurtry fair catches the kickoff at the 31-yard line. Couldn't afford to let it bounce, and McMurray was standing there, so he just fair caught it. And you certainly can do that. You can fair catch any kick before it hits the ground.
To look at Michigan and their running tendencies, left, middle, and right, and the yardage are doing much better to the right and left than they are up the middle.
In the last series, the Ohio State defense was just flying all over the place. No Bowles and no Horde now. They're both gone. Jared Bunch takes a hit from Tovar, who's been a dynamite defender here in the second half for the Buckeyes. And there just isn't anything there.
He looks like he's banged up.
Yeah, he got up.
This is another inside linebacker hurt for Ohio State.
As Sam would say, he's got a hitch in his get-along. Judah Herman's going to come back now. He's dinged up too, remember. He's been out. Eisenman, number 10 in there with a broken thumb. Bunch of game kids out there playing football. Tovar, 12 tackles as he leaves. I expect he'll be back. Clock rolling, 6:40. Second and eight. Michael Taylor got loose for a moment. And that's a good defensive play by Judah Herman, the sophomore. Just come back into the ball game, and he saw the quarterback about to slip away and got him. So it will be third and eight for Michigan.
Weren't with us earlier in the ball game, we mentioned the fact that Ohio State is playing without four starters defensively, all out with injuries for the year. Eisenman was a question mark coming in, and Herman was hurt earlier in the ball game. Now he's back.
Taylor's pass to Bunch. Good for a first down. Michael Taylor made that play.
No question about it. Michael Taylor made the play. He isn't the prettiest, but he's the most efficient, and that's why Jim Beckler likes to have Michael Taylor in there. First of all, he's a fifth-year senior, very intelligent player. Led the Big Ten in passing last year, passing efficiency. Is number two this year. Makes very few mistakes.
42-yard line now. We've got four more snaps and 5:20 to play, leading by 3 points. Alan Jefferson. We'll pick up 3 yards. Ken Colvin, the junior from Dayton, 92, the tackle for the Buckeyes.
Steve Everett, number 51, against Thomas, 54, in the middle of that line. Kind of a standoff there. Thomas got over and got a piece of the tackle. Everett is an outstanding center, just playing in his first year. He's a redshirt freshman.
Second out at six. Jefferson taken down by Eisenman. Garrick Eisenman, the senior from Fremont, Ohio.
Watch Eisenman here. Was not expected to play. Came into the game with a broken thumb. Runs right through a slow developing play. Doring from the left side was pulling across. Eisenman read it, ran through the opening in the line, and made a tackle for a loss. They call that a Big Ten college football behind the line of scrimmage.
Got another third and long now. Third and eight. Goodness, that Taylor made the play the last time. This time Taylor did not make the play because Greg McMurtry was slanting at full speed and wide open, full throttle, and Taylor missed him.
Threw it behind him.
McMurtry was, he might have broken that thing.
Yeah, no question. He's got the speed to do it. You have to throw that ball between the linebackers at the line of scrimmage. And he was trying to get it through there when he had an opening. One of the linebackers was coming over, and he tried to get it through there. Threw it behind him.
Well, Stapleton in the punt. Been a shaky exercise all day, but he got a little bit on this one at the 20-yard line, taken by Bobby Olive. And Olive will come on back up to the 33-34. 35-yard punt and a 14-yard return, and Todd Plate is shaken up on the play for Michigan. Todd Plate shaken up on the kick coverage. Has come off the field for a moment.
He's a starting corner. In fact, he's playing for the injured Lance Dotton. Plate was a walk-on a couple of years ago. He's earned a scholarship at Michigan.
Dwayne Ware, number eight, a redshirt freshman from Bloomington, Illinois, goes into the ballgame now for Michigan. Both teams have just absorbed tremendous number of injuries. There's Ware.
See if they continue to throw on first down.
If they do, they'll probably go right at him. Nope. Give it to Scotty Graham. And he's caught behind the line of scrimmage for a 3 yard loss. And it was Eric Anderson with the first hit on him. Anderson, number 37.
Anderson made a nice play. Watch as he plays off the block of the running back, steps in, fills the hole. That's Dante Lee. That's one of the things that people say, well, why doesn't Lee play all the time? He can run fast, he's quick. The problem is he doesn't block as well, and he doesn't all the time. The new people understand the offense and get the checkoffs when they occur at the line of scrimmage. Good
second example. And 12.
Good example right there.
Tries pass for Beatty. Intercepted by Plate, who had just come back into the ball game. Todd Plate had just come back. Comes up with a tremendous interception, and Vader Murray is now hurt on the field.
Murray actually ran into Plate after the interception. You know, this has been a hard-hitting, physical, tough ball game, but you don't expect it from your own player. To the right side of your screen, no, to the left side, excuse me. Plate's just going to cut in front of the receiver and makes a great interception. And right there, Murray was looking to block on Graham and didn't think he was going to have contact with Plate, and it looked like he may have hurt his shoulder.
The way they hit together, it looks like it.
Yeah.
Greg Fry suffering with that play, obviously. And time is out for Veda Murray. Veda Murray now, there's medical people all over the place. They brought a stretcher out. Normally, when you see this kind of precaution, it has to do with the neck.
Here's Murray, right here. Here's Murray right here. The collision is going to happen after the ball is caught. Plate makes the catch. He's bent back. Looks like he goes out. No, he looks up a little bit. Didn't get hit in his head or his neck, it didn't seem. It looked like it was a shoulder, or possibly from being bent back, maybe he hurt one of his lower legs. But it looked to me like it was a shoulder or something. May have knocked him out, too.
Well, he has not moved that I could tell. I mean, apparently they've been able to talk to him. But his legs have not moved. There's a pair of paramedics out there with the doctors.
Well, I think they may think it's a neck injury. It doesn't seem like that from the collision that we saw. If anything, I think it may have just knocked him out.
Well, it doesn't do any good to speculate. No, Bo obviously is out there. Yeah. The medical people are out there. John Cooper has come out on the field now. Everybody is concerned about Veda Murray, who is one of the outstanding young people playing this game in this country.
Twists his lower back, but, you know, usually when you have a serious injury to the neck or something like that, it's because you have a straight-on impact with your helmet and your neck is usually down. I don't know, it appears to me that he just got knocked out, and they can't, because he's turned over on his stomach, they really can't get in there to talk to him or see what the problem is. They don't want to move him because, for obvious reasons.
They have now managed to get the stretcher under him. They're going to take him off. See this.
Take a look at it from another angle.
See, the left shoulder of Plate hit him on the face mask here. It snapped his head back some. Most important thing here at this particular juncture is to get him somewhere where he can be taken care of. You have the frightening thoughts come tumbling through your mind when you're looking at a circumstance like this. And I don't want to get deep into speculation on it, because if, as Bob says, it's just a momentary thing, that's one thing. So time is still out for Veda Murray. Michigan leading 21 to wait for Veda Murray. Being very, very deliberate. Don't just arbitrarily go out and start rolling people around. At the conclusion of today's game, we'll select our Chevrolet Most Valuable Players from each of the teams. It'll be the 19th year that Chevrolet has participated in its scholarship program, with $1,000 being donated to the general scholarship fund of each of the schools. We have 2 minutes and 48 seconds to play in this 86th meeting between Ohio State and Michigan. The Michigan Wolverines are leading 21 to 18. And you can see him blinking his eyes and conversing with those around him. But they're not going to take any chances. They're going to spirit him off the field in a big hurry and keep all the medical attention necessary on him to ascertain his condition. It's a good thing these two teams only play each other once a year. Well, I mean, they flat wear each other out. They're so determined about things.
We hope that Veda is not seriously injured, and I think the length of time that it's taken to get him off the field doesn't necessarily mean that he is seriously injured
no,
either.
No, no.
It's just a precaution.
Right.
You know, we've seen this happen before where it's a precautionary thing and they get him to the hospital, check him out, and it's just something a lot less serious than, you know, what you think of the worst.
For you during the Arizona-Michigan basketball game, which will follow at 4 o'clock. All right, it's first down right here for Michigan, 21-18, and the ball is handed to Allen Jefferson, and Allen Jefferson is taken down by Derek Eisenman, number 10. Well, that's Greg Fry holding his head in the aftermath of the interception and the Murray injury. Ohio State has just called a timeout. That is the second timeout. Now it is the first timeout of the second half for Ohio State, so they have two remaining at 2 minutes and 39 seconds, and that play gaining nothing. So Michigan is now looking at second down and 10. And obviously, with a first down, we'd get another four snaps, and that would put Ohio State, that'd give them a pretty good-sized problem. To bring you up to date, if you've just joined us, in the first quarter, after a turnover, Michigan got on the board to lead 7-0 as Horde, who is out of the game hurt now, scored. In the second quarter, it went to 14-0 as Jefferson scored from the two. Then O'Morrow kicked a field goal to put Illinois on the scoreboard. But that came after Ohio State on the scoreboard. That came after the Buckeyes were inside the five, first and goal, and had to settle for three. Then the third quarter, another field goal, and then the rest of it you can see. Graham making it close at 21-18. Scotty Graham has had a huge day for Ohio State. Michael Taylor pitches it back. Allen Jefferson turns it upfield, runs back into the middle, and gets up across the 46-yard line. And there he is stopped. So you're looking at third down. Third and close to five.
Jefferson has come a long way. As a sophomore, he broke his leg. He came back after the break, continued to had some pain. The pain continued, practiced anyway. Finally, the pain was so severe, he had it checked out. Had some surgery to do and discovered there was a calcium deposit, the size, they said, of a golf ball. And when Schembechler found out how big and how painful that was, he immediately went over to the hospital and said, kid, you are one tough kid to play without.
On third and five, Taylor throws pass over the head of the intended receiver. However, a penalty flag is thrown. Vinnie Clark, number 7, defending against Desmond Howard, and Clark made the mistake, I think, of putting his arm out. And that's what got him in trouble. Pass interference against Ohio State. John Cooper wants a second opinion.
Well, he's not going to get it. Watch the right side of the screen as they'll come into the picture.
There he's got his hand out. He hadn't stuck that hand out, he might have gotten away with it, huh?
Yep.
All right, a quick moment with Mike Adamley.
Well, Keith, Veda Murray was just left the stadium. He was taken to the hospital in an ambulance. The good news is that he had movement in his hands and in his feet. The reason that the doctors are sending him to the hospital via ambulance is Veda did complain of some pains in his neck. So right now, it's just a precautionary thing taking him to the hospital. But again, the good news is that there was no paralysis in his arms or his legs.
All right, John Cooper raging on the sidelines now, absolutely convinced he got a bad call. He wanted a second opinion and couldn't get it. And it's first down, Michigan, at the Ohio State 40. Jefferson for about 3 yards, maybe four yards. And now Michigan is going to go the other way with it. It's Ohio State calling the timeout. He pointed to Michigan, but then turned around and changed it. So the Buckeyes have one timeout remaining. And Michigan right now, with a minute and 44 seconds to play in the game, is leading 21 to 18. But they have the ball, second down, and about seven on the Ohio State side of the field.
Let's go back and take a look at that interference. Here are the two players involved up here. Now watch as he comes down and breaks to the inside. Clark, number seven in the white jersey, will put his hand out and kind of shove him inside. That's a foul. That's a good call. And the reason he did that, it wasn't a zone. He didn't have a lot of help from linebackers inside. When the man broke across his face, he knew that he was by himself. And he didn't want to give up the big play.
You think that was a catchable ball?
I think it would have been if he hadn't have been shoved to the inside.
Okay.
If he hadn't been knocked off his route. And it's too close to determine if it wasn't.
All right, second down and seven for the Wolverines. Alan Jefferson. Defense after him. Defense gets him. 48 and 58 for Ohio State. Pelini and Tovar.
Well, if you're Michigan and you're running out the clock, you don't want to go out of bounds and help the opposition. It looked like he was trying to stay in bounds, but Pelini got the momentum going and just shoved him out. Saw Cooper there looking to Pelini and said, look to me, I'll tell you when to call the timeout.
1:37 to play. He's got one left. The ball is at the Ohio State 36-yard line. It is third down and six for Michigan.
What a nice job that Cooper has done coming over from Arizona last year. Tough year bringing this team back with all those injuries.
Ohio State's offside. McMurtry with a grab for a first down. Alonzo Spellman is offside. The offside would not give him a first down. The catch by McMurtry will. They'll decline it.
Offside.
The penalty doesn't matter. It was the catch by McMurtry that gave Michigan the first down. Clock shows 1:34 now and four more snaps.
Michigan continues to move down the field. Good call and a good throw. Nice catch by McMurtry.
I just had a feeling that this fellow might have a big day today. And if Taylor had hit him with that little slant in early on in this quarter, he might have had a touchdown. This is punt. Right ahead. And the big fellow's got at least 4 yards on the carry. Ohio State only has one timeout remaining. And they just spin it. To the injury of Veda Murray, as you heard Mike Adamley's report, he was moving his arms and his legs as he left in an ambulance. Here's what happened.
Well, it's certainly good news that we got from Mike Adamley.
Blake makes the interception, a great play in itself, then runs into his teammate Murray and has seemingly damaged him somewhere in the neck area, because he indicated he did have some pain in the neck area.
Shoulder. Collarbone, shoulder, something up in that area, it appeared to be.
It is second down now for Michigan, and 6 yards to go at 1:27 to play. All the timeouts are gone now for the Buckeyes.
Jim Beckler has never won a national championship, Keith, and you know there is a possibility if he goes on and wins this ball game, there's a possibility it could be out there for him.
Well, that's right, depending on what happens down in Miami tonight.
Miami beats Notre Dame, and Notre Dame goes on to the Orange Bowl and whips Colorado. Michigan is right there in third position right now.
But Jared Butch, Jared Butch, touchdown! That'll do it for Michigan. Dogged, gut tough determination.
Jared Bunch is the forgotten man in that backfield. We talk about the tailbacks with Bowles and Ford and Jefferson. Bunch just closes the door.
It's good.
Straight up the middle, watches Everett and the offensive line come off this way. Elliott is going to come around and pick off the linebacker, and there's a hole right up the middle. At least enough of a hole that Bunch can get through. Breaks the tackle of number 54, that's Thomas, and just carries defensive backs into the end zone. Look at it right from behind him. That's Pelini, 48, who hit him high, and Polk, number 22 also. He just carries him into the end zone. You can't hit him that high. He'll just run by you.
He needs a step, though, to get going, doesn't he?
Yeah. Well, he's 241, and he's not very big. He's 6'2", but he's got a lot of strength in the upper body.
Once he gets his step, you better be ready to rumble, because he's going to stand you on your head. That was a tough run and a big run. And the ball is fumbled in the end zone by Lee. He took his eyes off of it, obviously looking to see where he wanted to go with it. And now it'll come back out to the 20. Remember the basketball game coming up, matches defending national champion Michigan against Arizona. That'll be from Springfield, Massachusetts in the Hall of Fame Tip-Off Classic. Gary Bender, and what was that guy's name? That guy's been hollering at me all afternoon. What was that fellow's name?
I'll tell you what, I'm going to put my mic down. He's going to put this on. There'll be a few more words going out. Yeah.
Dick and I will be together next Saturday down in Indianapolis for Notre Dame Louisville. Starting our basketball coverage, then we come back in 2 weeks for Duke Michigan right here at Chrysler Arena. That's a great game coming up.
You still get paid the less for saying less?
Yes, of course. Huh? Same amount, yep. Checks don't bounce. Tote your bag and get the train. On first down, the ball rolling around on the ground. It's finally picked up by the Buckeyes. And Beatty, the center, picked it up. So things sorting is kind of coming unglued right here for the Buckeyes, because this one is over, really. They have no timeouts. You got a minute to play in the game. Michigan leading by 10, 28-18. Dave Burnson, our statistician. Todd Berry, our spotter. Greg Fry delivers it down the middle. The pass is caught by Bobby Olive, and he is drilled hard and knocked down, but it is the first down, and it does stop the clock. I got a hunch Ohio State will be even more troublesome next year.
Yeah, they'll have all those injured players healthy and back. Fry is back, Snow is back.
And some good redshirts.
Yeah, they had great recruiting year this year.
That's picked off and then dropped. J.J. Grant had an interception. And J.J. was, all he could see was a lot of green and fresh air. And my goodness, he dropped it.
You know, Keith, this is the end of the college football season for most of the teams. And, you know, there are still probably any of six or seven teams that could still win the national championship. He said Michigan had a chance, but if Notre Dame loses today and then beats Colorado, if Michigan would lose to Southern Cal, Nebraska and Florida State are ranked fourth and fifth. What if Nebraska beat Florida State? And Florida State has two losses. Do you vote them the national champ?
That's too complicated. Ball is marked just on the Michigan side of the field, and third down three is clock shows 20 seconds now. It's ticking away.
There you go.
That's
there you
caught
go.
By Palmer. And Palmer is inside. No, it is Graham. Graham, 84, and first down for Ohio State. The ball is at the Michigan 22, and the clock stops on the first down. A 10-point lead, however, for Michigan. Remember, Grant had the ball caught and then dropped it. Fry throws underneath to Scotty Graham. And three Wolverines pull him down. And for some reason, the clock has stopped. The crowd coming out on the field. But the game's not over, folks. Crowd wanting to come out and celebrate. Michigan wins, but it's not over. Greg Fry throws toward the end zone. That is incomplete. And now the game is over. And the Michigan Wolverines have won it by a score of 28-18. Here's Mike.
Well, Ball, this football game was... Coach, this football game was sort of a microcosm of your entire season. You had moments of greatness, moments when you weren't so good, but in the end, when it counted, you were able to put the Buckeyes away.
Well, turnovers hurt us. And let's give some credit to the Ohio State team. They're a vastly improved football team. And we're a little hurt, you know. Once we lost Horde, now we lost both our quarterbacks. But the fact remains we won the game. That's what counts.
Defensively, I think J.J. Grant epitomized what this team is all about. I mean, he's been hurt every single down.
He's playing hurt. And the defense hung in there. But if we hadn't turned the ball over, we could have had a nice lead at halftime. But as it turned out, we had to fight for our lives.
Is there anything wrong with Michael Taylor's arm?
Yeah, a little bit. He had a little problem during the week.
And have you heard anything more about Veta Murray? We saw him being taken in the ambulance. What did your doctors tell you?
I got my fingers crossed there. But he had feeling. It's not like he was paralyzed. He had feeling. But he was out for quite some time. Those things always scare you.
Well, congratulations on your second consecutive trip to the Rose Bowl. Thank you very much. Bo Schembechler, Keith.
All right, Mike, thanks very much. The Chevrolet most valuable players are Scotty Graham for Ohio State, Leroy Horde for Michigan. Big day for both men. Both men finished the game dinged up. Chevrolet donating $1,000 to each school's general scholarship fund, rewarding outstanding students for their academic achievements and assisting those in financial need. Well, it's been a long time since anybody repeated as Big Ten champion. Go back to 65-66 in Michigan State. But Michigan now has done it. 28-18 over Ohio State.